We've got a beautiful male lion and a female. We've just found them. They're just lying off the road. We're very, very lucky. We found these lions earlier today, and it looks like they've moved a little bit, and they're enjoying the shade. Just resting right off to the side of the road. Very, very fortunate to find them. So welcome again. My name is Byron, and with me on camera this afternoon, we've got Xander, or Eggsy, as some of you may know him. And we've got Taylor and Brian on the other vehicle with us this afternoon. Welcome to the ladies in the FC. Always great to have them with us. Rebecca and Kirsten. And a big welcome to all our viewers. It's always great to have all of you with us. And it's actually a wonderful afternoon. Bit of cloud cover now. It's cooled down a bit from the heat that we had earlier today. It's about 30 degrees Celsius or about 90 degrees Fahrenheit. So a lovely afternoon. And with this cloud cover now, it really is great being out here. We are situated in the northern Sabi Sands in the greater Kruger National Park, right up in the northeastern part of South Africa. We are on a game reserve known as Juma. It's great to have you with us again. Please don't forget that this is a live safari, and send us your questions or comments either at Twitter with hashtag SafariLive or otherwise email us questions@wildearth.tv. A lot going on, a lot of birds calling around us at the moment, and this is quite a nice afternoon drive too, a special afternoon drive, because we've got some little school kids joining us again, which is always great. It's lovely having young viewers, and hopefully they learn a lot while they're out on our safari with us this afternoon. These lions are completely relaxed. It is still very warm, so chances of them moving around quite slim. Now, lions conserve their energy in the heat. They try and relax as much as possible and lie in the shade, and then later on when it starts cooling down, they'll probably move around quite a bit. That's a beautiful lioness. And these lions are from the Nkuhuma pride. And a good afternoon to the school. I'm not sure which school it is. I think it's a Windsor Oaks Elementary. Lovely to have you with us this afternoon. Welcome to the little kids from Windsor Oaks. And please don't forget to ask Miss Hubble to send your questions through to us, and we'll gladly answer them. And don't worry, any questions are welcome. And we look forward to having your comments and questions. As I said, these little school kids are about 5 to 6 years old, and it's great that they are so interested in wildlife and they're able to join us. I'm going to sit with these lions for a little bit longer. While I do that, Taylor would like to say hello to you, and she's got a large animal with her that she wants to show you.
Good afternoon and welcome to an incredible sunset safari as normal. It looks like we might not have a sunset. And I very quickly want to welcome Windsor Oak Elementary School. Welcome, and we look forward to hearing all your questions. Now, my name is Taylor, and on camera with me, I've got to introduce you to someone special. Have a look at this little character. This is the Thumb, who's wearing a raincoat in preparation for the rain that we could get this afternoon. We're all keeping our fingers crossed. And that Thumb belongs to Brian, who's actually controlling the camera and getting all these incredible shots. But look at this little chap that we've found for you this afternoon. Can you see him there? This is a young elephant bull, and he has just pushed this tree down. Look at that. Not a very big tree, but I don't think that between Brian and I we'd be able to push it over. Now you can see he's digging, and the reason why he pushed that tree over was, as you saw there, he's picked up a root. He wants to eat the root. Very excited to see the elephant. This is incredible that we're just sitting meters from a wild animal. And I'd love to hear from you. So if you've got any questions that you'd like to ask me, or if, even if you'd like to ask Byron, I'd love to hear from you. So is there anybody sitting watching here who perhaps thinks that the elephant is their favorite animal? I'd love to hear from you. So ask your teacher to send us a message and tell us who of you love elephants. And remember, I can try and answer any questions you have about any of the animals. And I'd like to hear some about some questions from you about this elephant and see if we can learn a little bit this afternoon. Something very important is that you must remember to keep your volume turned up nice and loud, because there's all sorts of sounds that are going on in the background. Lots of birds chatting, and you may even hear this elephant as he tears up the roots from the ground. Oh, we had an unexpected visitor. Listen to this. Do you see that little bird in there? That is a crested Franklin making all of that noise, and he gave me a little bit of a fright the way he came flying and landing in here like a big Boeing. I'm surprised he didn't give Mr. Elephant a fright. Now, it's very important that the elephants are able to push these big trees down, because at the moment when there's not too much food around, he needs to be able to eat the roots. Oh, Riley, you and I seem to have a telepathic connection. We're both thinking of exactly the same things today. So, Riley, you want to know, why do the elephants like to eat the trees? At the moment, it's really the only food that's around for them. There's not very much grass, but we did have lots and lots of rain yesterday. So in a few days' time, I think that the grass will be nice and green again. We unfortunately have been experiencing a drought, and we are hoping that it's going to end this year. But by digging for the roots, there's lots of water in those roots.
Do elephants
also eat grass, Samir? You're wondering if the elephants also eat grass. Now, Samir, the elephants actually can eat everything. Of course, they don't eat other animals. They are just vegetarians. They like to eat grass when it is around. But unfortunately, in this area, it seems as though they feed predominantly on all the leaves. And they can even dig. And that's what those tusks are for, those big white things sticking out of his face, which is, it's like a tooth. It's a modification of an incisor. Those big white things called tusks, and they can stick them into the ground and loosen the soil and dig for things like bulbs and of course roots and even water. So even when there isn't any water around, can you believe it that these elephants are able to have a look? Sorry, Rebecca. So I want you to have a look at me now. I need to do some dental work here, but come and have a look and let me show you my absolute best. I've got to hope, am I getting it on the right one? Brian, is that my incisor? Is that it? Is it? I can't feel where I'm going.
Oh, there now.
I can't see what I'm doing in my mouth at the moment, but those funny sharp teeth that you have on the side of your face, that's exactly what those are over there, but they're a little bit different. I wish I had teeth like that, because then I'd be able to dig under the ground with my mouth. Wouldn't that be lots of fun?
Elijah.
Now, Elijah, like I said, we just missed this elephant pushing the tree down. Unfortunately, this elephant was feeling a little bit hungry. They like to eat all the time, and they need to eat lots all day long. And that's why he pushed the tree down. It's very difficult to see now because he is hiding behind the tree, but he's eating the roots that grow underneath the ground. There you can see a couple of them, a little bit higher, I think you might see them, that are sticking out. Can you see that little thin piece on the top of your screen? And there we go. Look at that. You see that reddish color amongst the gray? That is a root below the surface of the ground. And that's what he's digging for. It's almost like as if you were digging in the sand for some treasure. That's exactly what that elephant is looking for. Tristan, you want to know how the elephant pushed the tree down? With his muscles. He is very strong, and because he is the largest land mammal in the world, not even just in Africa, he is able to push things down like that. So what they will do is they'll walk up to the tree, and it depends how big it is. Normally, if it's a big tree with a big trunk, he'll lift his trunk up and put it onto the top of his head, and then he will push against it with all his might and power until it starts to crack. And sometimes you'll see them shaking it, pushing their head back and forth, and eventually the tree will snap and then fall over. But the idea is to try and get the roots from below the ground. So they don't want to snap the tree in the middle. They want to make sure that they push it, and all those roots, which are like chocolate, I suppose, for the elephants. So you can imagine they dig for it all the time, especially when there's not a lot of grass and stuff around.
Comment, Jayana. I love all these animals, Jayana.
Jayana, you're saying that you love all these animals? Well, I hope this is not the only animal we're going to see this afternoon. Hopefully we're going to see lots and lots of them. Now let's see if we can watch this elephant and see how it uses its trunk. He doesn't seem to be eating now. Perhaps he's too full and he's taking a little breather and just having a little break. It's almost like how much you eat on Thanksgiving. I'm sure that you know exactly, or on Christmas, or whichever day of the year you like to eat lots. Well, then you know how you feel after you've had lots of mom or dad's cooking.
Why was that bird making such a noise, Riley?
Now, that bird was making an interesting noise when he came running in here, but he has gone now. And the reason, Riley, that he was making all that noise is I think he was declaring his territory. So what that means is that he was shouting to all the other birds in the area that are crested Franklins, telling them that this is my space, I live here, don't come and take my home, this is occupied already. So there's somebody already living there. Maybe he's even trying to sing to the ladies, and he's trying to take them out maybe for a nice dinner and spoil his potential wife. Cody, you're wondering if we're going to see monkeys. Now, we may see monkeys, I'm not sure. We'll have to try and find some, but I know a few spots that we could see them, so perhaps we will leave this elephant now, and we'll head across and see if I can't search some beautiful trees that might have some fruit. And while I do so and look for the monkeys for Cody, let's go back across to Byron and see how those lions are doing.
Look at this, everybody. We've just found a beautiful little bird. This is called a plum-colored starling. Oh, there it goes. Just in time for you to see it. A beautiful, beautiful bird. I'm so great that Taylor got to show you the elephant. We're still sitting with these two beautiful lions. Haven't moved much. Have a look at this female. The flies are bothering her a little bit. Michaela, good afternoon, Michaela. And Michaela has asked us, will the lions wake up soon? So Michaela, you can see this female, that one over there, she is awake, but she is still resting. It's still very hot. So the lions don't like to move around too much when it's hot. And you can see the male next to her is resting very comfortably there. In the shade of the tree. He's not interested in moving anytime soon. Look at that. Look at that big mane. All that hair around his neck and his head. It's called the mane. And that's a big, big male. Look, he's sitting up. Oh, look at that. Look at those teeth, everyone. See how sharp those teeth are. Wow. Look at the female's paw. Beautiful. If you look closely at that male, look at his face. He's got lots of scratches around his face. Can you see that, everyone? All those little scars. And often the males look like this because they do get into a lot of fights with each other. And when they're trying to fight for dominance and territory, so to be the king of the jungle, the males fight with each other. And they often get very bad scars. And this male on the other side of his face has got a very, very bad scratch. And we're not too sure exactly what had happened. Maybe a fight with another male. And they just caught him with a claw or bit his nose a little bit. Maybe he got injured while he was hunting. We don't know. But you can't see it now. It's on the other side of his face. And look at that female cleaning herself. Maybe trying to get rid of some fleas or ticks. And little Tristan, good afternoon, Tristan. Tristan has asked, do the lions only move when it is cooler? So Tristan, not necessarily. Generally, the lions like to rest when it is hot and they prefer moving when it is cooler. But I have seen lions move during the day and even hunt during the day when it is hot. It all depends if there's food nearby. But at the moment, these two look very relaxed and they don't look like they want to move anytime soon. For those viewers who have just joined us, we have got a little school with us this afternoon, Windsor Oaks Elementary. And the little four and five-year-olds, I believe, that are watching. It's lovely to have them with us. And kids, don't forget to ask Mrs. Hubble to send through your questions or your comments. Myself and Taylor will happily try to answer them for you. Now look at that face of the female. See, not nearly as much scarring as you could see on the male. She's got a beautiful face. Oh, hang on, there we go. Looks like the male was just playing with the female, biting her tail. See, they didn't want to move too far. Look at that yawn. That is a huge male. Very, very big. Can see their bellies are quite full. Look at that belly of the male. And that is because these lions have been very lucky or successful the last few days. They've caught some buffalo and they've fed on buffalo. And that's nature, everyone. So Jayana has just asked exactly that. What do the lions eat? So Jayana, as I said, they do feed on buffalo, but the lions will also eat different types of antelope. So those are the different, almost like you have deer in North America. We have antelope in this area. So little impala, kudu, and hopefully we'll get to show you some of those antelope over the next short time or the next few minutes, but these lions have been feeding on buffalo, so they're very, very full at the moment. I'm going to have a look and see if I can't find the rest of the pride, which were in the area a little bit earlier. While I do that, let's get an update from Taylor.
Well, seeing as though Byron was just telling you about the favorite food of the lions, we managed to find one that is still alive. Now, this is an African buffalo, and this looks like a young male. He isn't quite as big and strong as he should be just yet. He's still growing, and you can see he's eating his vegetables. You see that? He's having some leaves, and he prefers to eat grass, though. But because there's no grass around at the moment, well, he has to make do with whatever he can find, which seems to be leaves at the moment. Now, Mr. Buffalo, you better be very careful not to go too far that way. Otherwise, you're going to find the Nkuhumas. And remember, the Nkuhumas are the lions you just saw. That's their name. And off he goes. Probably going to go and try and find some water. Maybe he's going to go and have a little drink, or even to try and keep nice and cold. Sometimes they will sit in the water and cover themselves with lots and lots of mud. But this buffalo has actually got a very long tongue, as you can see, using it to hold onto the leaves and pull them off the stem and then put it in his mouth. Imagine if you ate your dinner like that. I don't think your mom would be very impressed if you stuck your tongue out and tried to use it like a buffalo would. It's very quiet out here. There's not too many birds chatting, no more crested Franklin's coming to disturb the animals, but I did see something else that was up ahead. Should I show you the tallest land mammal in Africa? Are you excited? Can you guess what the tallest African land mammal is? Like to hear, so quickly send in some of your answers as quick as you can, because it's just up and around the corner. Now, I want to hear a few of your guesses before we get there. So what do you think the tallest animal in the world is? Not even just in Africa. Maybe you've already spotted it, I don't know. Anybody guess? Got just a few seconds to get some answers in. Right, I'm going to reveal the tallest animal in Africa. And there it is. Let's try and get a better view. Can you see him? He's walking away from us, though. He doesn't want to stay this afternoon. And that, of course, is a giraffe. And that is a big boy giraffe. He is nice and tall. He can stand at almost 5.5 meters tall. I reckon if you had to stand right next to a giraffe and look up, you would probably get a very sore neck from staring, almost looking straight to the sky. Well done. I believe that all of you guessed that it was a giraffe, so congratulations. That is a very good answer, and I'm glad that all of you got it right. So congratulations, everyone. That was fantastically done. Now, this is an animal that loves to eat the leaves, and they normally only just eat leaves. I don't think I've ever seen a giraffe eating grass before, because you see, sometimes there's animals out there and we say that they only eat grass or they only eat leaves, but sometimes they'll eat either or if there's nothing else around. But luckily for the giraffe, there are normally quite a few different types of trees that have leaves all year round. So that's called evergreen. Look at that little bird sitting on the giraffe's shoulder or his wither. Can you see that? That is called an oxpecker. Now, it's one of my favorite birds, and they're quite funny to watch. And you're probably sitting there wondering, what is that oxpecker doing on that giraffe? And why is that giraffe not getting annoyed by the oxpecker? Well, they have a very nice relationship together. So they work together in life. The oxpecker helps clean the giraffe and remove all the ectoparasites. Now, that's a big word, but it's basically any insects that suck the blood of the different animals. So ticks and fleas and mites, that oxpecker will rid that giraffe of all those little insects. And then, of course, in return, the giraffe is repaid by having a free cleaning service. And, of course, it's food for that oxpecker, too. So they live in life very happily together. But you don't just see the oxpeckers on the giraffe. You can also see them on the buffalo, on the elephants, on the rhinos, even on the impala, which is an antelope. You very happily eating there. Has anybody got any questions for me? Come on, somebody must be asking something about a giraffe. These are very interesting creatures, and I'd love to hear from you. I'm sitting waiting with a big smile on my face, hoping that somebody's going to ask a question. Who's it going to be? But unfortunately, this giraffe is walking away now, and he looks like he's about to really disappear into the distance behind all the thick trees. And we're going to stay on the road, though. We're not going to go off-roading for this giraffe, because we don't want to make a new road in the bush. We'd rather leave it and just view him from a distance. But there he's gone. He's completely disappeared. But what we're going to do is we're going to check a watering hole. Brian, there's a watering hole up here.
I think so.
We think there is one. Let's go and have a look around the corner. There we go, Tristan. Hello. Thank you for asking a question. Tristan, I know the giraffe has disappeared, but you wanted to know, why is there a pattern on the giraffe? Now, the different colors and the different patterns on the giraffe, not just the giraffe, but all the different animals in the world, it's very, very important to have more than one color, because that helps you blend into the vegetation very well. So the big word camouflage, you can use that. That's what it helps, it does. So the more stripes you have, the more spots or the more blotches that you have on your body, like we saw with the giraffe, the better you are at hiding away in the bush. Even something like a big gray elephant can hide away really well, which I didn't think when I was little that they could ever hide away. So Sally, you're wondering where that giraffe went. Now, Sally, unfortunately, the giraffe and all the animals, actually not unfortunately, it's a good thing, is they've got almost 8.5 million acres of land to move around on. Isn't that quite spectacular that they've got such a big home to live in? So they are not in a zoo or anything like this. This is actually all happening right now, and these are wild animals. So he just decided that he doesn't want to stick around with us anymore. And let me go and have a look around the dam and see if I can find anything interesting. Let's go back across to Byron, who's got something to show you.
Look, yeah, everybody, look what we've managed to find. It's quite a thick area, and we just got a glimpse of them. But yeah, it's the rest of the pride with the little cubs. Look at them sleeping, all in the shade, resting. There we go, there's one of the cubs. You can see the ears flicking. Completely relaxed, look at that. Isn't that wonderful? And Riley asked us a question. She would like to know, do the lions like to play with each other? Yes, Riley, they do indeed, especially when they're young. The little cubs are very, very playful. Not now because they're resting, because it's still very hot. But Riley, they do love to play, and that's the way they learn. When they're playing the whole time and jumping and catching and chasing each other, all of that teaches them how to hunt when they get older. So the lions do like to play with each other, even adults sometimes. The females, we saw the other day, two females were running and chasing each other and playing. So they do sometimes like to play with each other. I'm so glad we got to show you the little cubs and the little babies. That's the big mother that is lying to the right, and then the rest of the little cubs over there. And there's one big female in there too. It's a bit difficult to see. You can just see her big leg. There we go, that's the leg of the other mother. And this is very special. So these little cubs are about, we think, about 4 months old, almost 5 months old now. So they're quite big, and they're already eating meat with the parents, with their mothers, and the big males. These lions are probably still going to stay in this area for a long time, until it gets a bit cooler, and the temperature becomes cooler and drops. And so that will mean a little bit later this afternoon and maybe even early evening. So just when some of you are getting ready for bed, these lions will start waking up and moving around quite a lot and maybe even looking for food tonight. Elijah has asked us a question, and Elijah would like to know, would the babies ever leave their mommies? So Elijah, no, when they are young, they have to stay with their mommies, because otherwise they won't be able to get any food. So when they are very young, the babies or the cubs will stay very close to their moms and or to their mothers until they get a little bit older. And when they get much older, just like we sometimes leave our parents' homes when we get older, some of the cubs, and mainly the males, might leave the pride or leave the family. And they will go and set up a territory or a home for themselves somewhere else. But the female little cubs, the young girls, they will stay within the group, within the family. So Tristan has asked us a question, and Tristan wants to know, why don't the babies wander off or move away? So Tristan, the reason is because they know that the females, the big females or their mothers, protect them. If these little cubs or babies were by themselves, they would be in some serious trouble, because they could maybe bump into another predator like a hyena or maybe even a leopard. So it is much safer for them to stay with their parents. Or with the mothers and the father if he is around. Now, these babies are still busy sleeping. Taylor has got another baby that she would like to show you.
Look at this very funny little elephant. It's quite difficult to see him though, but it's the one in the middle between the two elephants. He has found himself a little hole which mom has dug for some water in this riverbed, but now he's leaving very disappointed because he didn't get anything to drink. I think that hole was a little bit too deep for his short trunk. Don't worry, little one, in a few years time you'll be digging your own holes and looking for your own water. Now unfortunately it's that time of the afternoon. We're going to have to say goodbye to all of you at Windsor Oak Elementary, but it has been an absolutely lovely afternoon, and I look forward to hearing from all of you soon. So just from myself and of course the Thumb and Brian, and I'm glad that you all enjoyed it, but we're going to have to say goodbye now. So we'll see you next time. Look what we found over here. We found a lovely herd of elephants down in a dry riverbed or a drainage line, which doesn't surprise me at all because it's the nice cool and the coolest spot to be out in the today. It wasn't as hot as what it was yesterday, but it's fairly warm. And now we're going to see if this elephant that's sort of behind the rest of the herd is going to go to a little hole that's just ahead of it, which one of the other elephants has actually dug. And we must have missed them digging this hole to get some fresh water. Would have been amazing to see that. I haven't seen elephants digging for water since Zambia, which was quite special to see that, how they go down, use their tusks to loosen the soil and then kick it out with their feet, scoop it out with their trunks. And that's the best way. I think if I was an elephant, I'd probably dig for water all the time, because you know you're going to get those beautiful fresh upwellings of cold water, not the hot water that's been sitting in the sun all day. And it'd be so refreshing. But they're very happy down there, and we're quite thankful though that it has started to cool down a little bit, but it's fairly humid. When we're driving, it's obviously nice and cool, and I can imagine that we feel when we're moving in the vehicle exactly what the elephants are feeling at the moment while they're flapping their ears, a lovely cool breeze on our skin. And remember, we are on a live safari, so myself and Byron would love to hear from you. You can either do so by hashtagging Safari Live on Twitter, or you can send us emails, questions@wildearth.tv. Sorry, having a good little chuckle at myself. When Rebecca was talking, I could hear everything that I was saying. And you know what it's like when you do a video, or Brian is laughing hysterically. So if you see the camera shake, that's why he's having, really having the good giggles there. But you know what it's like when you hear the sound of your own voice, you think you sound terrible. And now it was horribly embarrassing, but just to myself, of course, having a good chuckle. Now, I hope I really don't sound that bad. And Jason, I know you were asking this afternoon, what's the largest group of elephants that I've come across? Now, the biggest herds I ever saw were on the plains in the Lower Zambezi National Park. They were massive, but it wasn't just one herd. It was a few groups of elephants that have come together, and sort of just after the rains, almost to do their migration, like they'd come from maybe further south in the park or further north in the park, wherever they had been, and maybe even swam across from Zimbabwe and decided to come across because we had some lovely rain and eat all the new grass that was coming through. And I saw about 300 elephants or so together, and that was really special. I'm sure it could have been a couple more, but I couldn't quite count all of them. And that was really nice to see. The biggest herd of elephants I've seen in the Sabi Sands was actually down in the south, and I saw about 150 together, and it was absolutely beautiful, also out onto an open plain. But I really love this view from up top here. Normally we only get sort of and the same eye level view of an elephant. Well, maybe they're obviously a little bit bigger. It's nice to look down onto them as they move along this drainage line, and we're really not bothering them at all. They're completely relaxed with us being here. We're not even in their comfort zone or anything like that. They're completely ignoring us, which is also quite nice. But they're moving so slowly, and they look so peaceful this afternoon. Oh, and having a little bit of a siesta as she goes along. You can see how she's resting her trunk on the ground, just relaxing. And I'm sure that lovely wet sand that's down there, you can see it's not as white and fluffy as it normally is. I'm sure that must be quite nice, that cool touch to the skin. I'm trying to think. Yesterday the temperature was about 97 degrees Fahrenheit, and I think today it's only about 90. And we can definitely notice the difference. I'm so happy that we're not in that sweltering heat again. This morning got quite hot. And then luckily it cooled off slightly. And off they slowly go, carrying on. This little one's not venturing too far from mom, and hasn't the entire time we've been there. Oh, there we go, going in for a suckle. Now I'm sure that this calf is coming to the end of its days, its suckling days. It looks fairly large from up top here. It looks to be probably around three and a half years old. So I don't think it will be suckling for too much longer. And hopefully mom's got another little Ellie calf starting to develop inside her womb, so we can keep those populations of all the different animals growing. That's what we need. And off they go. Isn't this lovely? Well, I think we're going to move on from here, though. We want to carry on checking the watering holes. Right, but let's go back to Byron, who's got some very sleeping kahumas this afternoon.
That's right, Taylor. They are indeed sleepy. They're still resting. It is still quite warm, so I think that's why they're just enjoying the cool shade of this drainage line and the cool sand. It's one of the lionesses over there. Jason has asked for a cub count. Jason, let me just have a look quickly with my binoculars. I think, okay, what have I got? Jason, it's a bit tricky. It is quite thick at the moment. I can see six. I've counted six. But hang on, there's one up there. Six, seven, eight. Yeah, all eight are here. Yeah, all eight are here, Jason. I've seen them there. They spread around all over the place a little bit. So all eight cubs are here with the females and the one male. One male's just lying, you can't actually see him very well. He's in the really dense bush just below us. You can see how thick it is in there. And you know, we always say, well, these lions do rest a lot and they conserve their energy, and even though it looks like they are fast asleep, I can promise you and guarantee you that if something had to walk past, a buffalo or an impala or anything like that, and these lions picked up on the movement or the sound or the smell, they would be up in a flash and they would still hunt. It's happened quite a few times. I've been fortunate to see it myself, sitting in a sighting with lions, afternoon just like this, very warm, and all of a sudden a antelope has come running through, and they were up in a flash and they managed to catch it. Was actually an impala on both occasions, or two occasions that I saw it, and it is incredible to see how quickly they react when they have to or when they want food. So even though they look like they're asleep, they're still completely aware of what is going on around them, which is fascinating. A lot of birds calling above us, some starlings. Up over there, there we go. Oh, they might sit just off to the left. There's a nice little, we go a little bit further left, there we go, right out in the open on that dead tree. Two starlings, Birchall's starlings, a little bit larger than the Cape glossy starling or the greater blue-eared starling. Those are three species we get here that look very similar, except the Birchall starling is much, much larger than the other two species, and that's these ones that we have here. Speaking about the birds, a few comments this morning about the kingfisher that we saw, and just to clarify, it was the brown hooded kingfisher. It was not the woodlands kingfisher. We're still waiting to see when we're going to hear them and possibly see some of those when they return, maybe a little bit later in the month or possibly beginning of next month. But this morning's kingfisher was a brown hooded kingfisher. And because of all the rain, the wonderful rain we had last night, we had a big storm. Those of you who missed this morning's drive, it was incredible. Thunder, lightning, hail. And because of that, we've seen a lot of insects this morning. A lot more insects became active. And Taylor has one of the insects, a very interesting insect, that she's going to show you.
Seen as though we broke the curse and we found those large copper dung beetles earlier this morning, I found another one for you. Now I've picked it up. And just to show you how small this little dung beetle is in comparison to my finger, I want to turn it around quickly. Please say hello to the camera. There it is. There's the face of this little dung beetle. And isn't it precious? Beautiful greens on it, a little bit of copper as well, just on the edges of the shell. Now, this little dung beetle over here is most likely the male who's rolled this beautiful ball of, I'm not sure what dung I've actually got in my hands. Please don't be lying, though I think I would probably smell it. So it does smell like some sort of herbivore's dung. And I'm probably going to put it down in a moment and then I'll carry on telling you about it. But I just thought I'd give you a little show. But what this male does, I'm going to quickly pop it back down onto the ground. Yes, I'm going now. Oh, sorry, here we go. Here's your ball. Take it back. And off they go, happily as ever. And I think that male has done a great job building that beautiful ball. And hopefully he gets to find a lady who he'll be able to present it to. And hopefully she'll accept his gift. Sorry, I'm bending down. I'm looking for my little box to plug my earpiece in. Now, don't be careful now. Don't come on the road. We don't want you to get run over. And if she does accept it, well, they'll take it down and they'll bury it. And then she'll lay one little egg inside that ball where the larvae will then hatch and eat its way out. So it's not just a home for the larvae, an environment for the larvae to hatch in, but it's also a source of food which it will munch away. And then it will pupate and turn into a bigger dung beetle. So that's always quite fun to see so many of them. And hopefully we'll find a big bit of dung, fresh dung, maybe some elephant dung. And hopefully we'll get some beautiful, I'm just having a look at the sky, and hopefully we'll get lots of different dung beetles. Have a look at the light coming through the clouds. This is so special. Now, Byron is chatting about the thunder and lightning, and Brian thinks that we could possibly get some rain, and that's of course why the thumb has got a raincoat on. But isn't this beautiful? Isn't this lovely? I just wanted to say hello to Herbert. Hello, Herbert. How's it going?
Good,
you can hear Herbert is next to me. Now, Fran, you're wondering how much rain we got last night. Herbert, did you check the rain gauge? 20 mils, thank you so much. I thought it was somewhere around there, but I didn't get an opportunity to check the rain gauge, unfortunately. So quite a bit, Fran. I think it's going to do the lovely grass and all the trees lots of good. And I hope to see now that we've had the second burst of rain that we are going to get some flowers that are going to start popping through, other than just the morning glory and the string of stars. There's one in particular I'm after, and I can't wait to find it so I can show you. And that is, of course, the roadside pimpernel, or the lion's eye, that bright orange flower that grows out here in the African bush. Now, I want to have a conversation with Herbert. Oh, we have a request. Okay, we'll get back to that request. Now, I just want to chat to Herbie. Herbie, are you just doing a drive? There's Herbie. Are you looking for...
No, I've been trying to see if I can pick up some leopard tracks, but unfortunately, they are still on Hoffman.
Oh, no. So it sounds like Herbie was out trying to find us some leopards this afternoon, but it seems as though they are just off our traverse. But that's okay. Maybe we get lucky a little bit later and possibly one will come down. Hey, Herbie, what's your plan now? Are you carrying on with the drive or are you going home?
No, I'm...
driving around.
Yeah.
Herbie, the number one tracker, is going to help us find a leopard. And you know him, he always prevails. He found the Nkahumas this morning, which I could have possibly accidentally driven past. But anyway, Herbie, have a great afternoon. And we will see you a little bit later, but let's carry on. We're actually going to turn around. So Brian was saying that he wants to see the dams today. There we go. Sorry, I was just listening to a nice request that we have had come in this afternoon from Musical. Now, Some of you may have remembered a few, almost a month ago or so now, when we had our first bouts of rain, that I decided to pick a spot and we monitored how the grass was growing. Now, Musical would wants to know if we can perhaps stop past there. We can indeed do so. And maybe what I'd like to even do is, because the animals have eaten most of the grass, it's almost like we've had to start from the beginning again. Perhaps we're going to try a different section. And I have an area in mind. It's around Impala Road, quite close to Vuyatela Access. And the reason why I want to choose this area is after the last rains, I couldn't believe the rate at which the grass was growing, and it covered, almost carpeted that area so quickly. So I think it would be quite nice to change it up a little bit, and let's do a different shot. So we'll do a big loop. We're going to do a tour of all the dams this afternoon in case you missed the morning show, and we'll show you how much water we had. And I know that Brian said that he'd like to see how much water is in sort of Biffleshoek Dam, because I told him, and he doesn't want to believe me, that it's almost full to the top. It's not really full to the top, but it's the fullest that I've seen it since I've been here. So that was nice. So 20 mils of rain exactly. I sort of guessed this morning I was somewhere around there, but I'm glad. Now, welcome Paula. Paula, I believe that you're a new viewer. We're so happy to have you watching us, and we hope that you enjoy it, and keep asking as many questions as you like. And you'd like to know this afternoon, do we ever put water out for the animals if there isn't rain? So the answer to that question is, in fact, yes, we do, but a very minimal amount. And one of the reasons why we have the odd sort of man-made pan where we pump water, and like I said, it's not usually a large quantity, is just because of all the build-up around these natural areas in the communities, and drawing water from the river sources, as we have and as man have done over thousands of years now, is that unfortunately these rivers that would have flown naturally seem to have sort of dried out. So we just provide a little bit of extra water as a helping hand. But like I said, it's not enough. Even then, we get to a point where we can't pump any more water. And if it runs out, well then, unfortunately, it runs out. And these animals do have the ability to migrate either further north or south, and there are plenty of parts where they can then drink water. We saw that elephant today, how it was digging for water. Well, we just missed it digging for the water. I used to see in Zambia big herds of elephants moving through the beautiful big dry riverbeds in the dry season, and they would all dig a couple of holes, and we'd see the impala and the zebra and waterbuck actually following the elephants, and once they'd moved out, they'd come through afterwards and drink from some of those elephant holes with the beautiful fresh upwellings of water I was telling you about earlier. So that's a strategy that, you know, they can rely on other animals for digging water for them. In this area, it's not so common though. Up in the north, we don't seem to have big drainage systems or riverbeds, and that's where it's important for the animals to perhaps move even further north into the Manyelet, into the Tibavati, or further south down towards the Sabi River and the Sand River, and of course the Crocodile River, and those areas where there still seem to be quite a bit of water throughout the year. Well, that's the sort of idea behind it. Now, I'm also just checking along the drainage lines that we have seen Karula sort of moving around before, or for anyone really, any of the leopards, but I haven't seen any tracks yet. It's getting to the point where we're bound to have one pop out in front of us, or come across and around the corner and see a leopard in a marula tree, in a torchwood tree. Oh, this is something I need to remember. Tomorrow I have to remember to bring the little marula fruit that I found with me. I found it on the floor in camp, and I will bring that tomorrow morning. I'll put it in my pocket this evening. Now, but let's go back across to Byron and get a little update on those in Kahumas.
So, Taylor, we've actually just left the Nkuhuma Pride, and everyone who just left them, they're fast asleep or resting until it gets a bit cooler. So we're probably going to try return there a little bit later. Hang on, I've seen some elephant. Yeah, so we'll probably go back a little bit later. They're resting. It's a bit tricky to view them from there, well, where they were. So maybe we're lucky and they come out a little bit later on. Have a look. Can you see that elephant through there? There we go. Actually heard these branches or these elephant breaking branches from where we were sitting with the lions. I really can't tell you how happy I've been the last 3 or 4 days. There's just been elephant everywhere. It is so wonderful. I really, really love watching elephants. I can spend hours with them. See how that elephant's using his trunk to pick small little branches or leaves. And we've got a question from Lady Kashara, and she would like to know, how old is the oldest elephant in the area? We don't know. It's almost impossible to tell. The reason is there are so many elephants within the Greater Kruger National Park. The African elephant, though, the average age that they suspect they live up to is about 55 to 60 years old. So the oldest one in this area is possibly somewhere around there. But I don't know, we'd have to see a very, very old bull. There are not too many of them walking around. But that would be the oldest, is somewhere around there, that age. So almost 60 years old. See that elephant flapping its ears? And it's doing that because it's trying to cool down. So if you look closely, see those veins behind the ears, at the back of the ear, you can actually see that very clearly. Now, what these elephants do is they flap their ears. Their ears aren't very thick. The skin is very, very soft and thin. And what they do is they flap their ears like this. And what it does is it cools the blood that is running through those veins in the ears. And it takes about 7 to 9 minutes for the blood to circulate through the entire body. And slowly but surely, the temperature, the body temperature is cooled by the flapping of the ears and cooling of the blood. Not by much, but it does help regulate temperature slightly. Really is incredible. And we've got a question from Rob in Liverpool. Good afternoon, Rob. And Rob would like to know, what is the hottest temperature I've ever had to drive in or take an afternoon game drive? I'm trying to think now, Rob. I think it's probably around 46 degrees, 45, 46 degrees Celsius. I think it's around 110, 114 degrees Fahrenheit, somewhere around there. So very, very hot. And yeah, that's probably the hottest. But in some parts of the country, depending on the time of year, it gets even hotter. And Rob, you also want to know, does it ever get too uncomfortable? it's difficult to say. It can get a bit uncomfortable. But you know what we try and do then is try and move through the drainage lines, through the cooler areas, not really park out in the sun, maybe park under the trees. We've got a bit of shade that usually helps alleviate the heat a little bit, but it can be really hot at times. I know in some parts of the Kalahari it gets up to about 50 degrees Celsius, and that's the kind of the western to northwestern part of South Africa, and it's very, very hot out there. See if there are any other elephants around. Just saw two or three down there that were feeding. There weren't many more I could see. There's another one. They're just dotted. through or around this drainage line. I think what they're doing is trying to feed on the green vegetation that you find down there. Because of the water that is usually found within these drainage lines, the water table is much higher than it would be up in these areas, up on the crests. So what happens is there's a lot more vegetation, green vegetation, for those animals to feed on, like the elephant. There's a lot of humidity in the air this afternoon. It feels like the rain is building again. Not too sure. A lot of cloud cover, but there is a lot of humidity, and you can feel it. It's quite muggy. Approaching a little water hole up ahead, or a little dam. We saw how some of these areas filled up this morning from the rain that we had last night. We'll see, maybe we're lucky and something is drinking around here. And some impala already, and now just in front of us. We need to stop and look at these impala a little bit. They're so beautiful. They really are. And very, very soon, these impala are all going to start lambing. And I think we may have to start taking bets on when the first impala lamb is seen. I know we've all put down our guesses for when the first woodlands kingfisher is going to arrive and is going to be heard. But I think the impala lamb has to be on that list too, the first impala lamb. So maybe we'll sit around this evening and discuss it with the rest of the team. Very graceful antelope, beautiful antelope. Sometimes we take for granted, because there are so many of them, and we take it for granted when we do see them. It's wonderful to spend time and watch these antelope. I mean, they are incredible. They are so alert, so aware, and very fast and agile animals. The impala do this wonderful display known as stotting. And occasionally you see them when they run and they jump. They almost rock in the air. They basically lift their back legs and drop their front legs. And they leap these huge heights and distances. It's wonderful to see. Saw a little bird land in the tree. I just want to see if it's something. It's a wattled starling that's just flown, but it's a bit difficult to see. I don't think you'd be able to see it now. And well camouflaged. A lot of wattled starlings around at the moment. We're going to continue looking around this area. Taylor's got a striped animal to show you.
And of course, a game drive would not be complete without our daily dose of zebra and, of course, buffalo. And I'm sure we will find many more buffalo this afternoon. Perhaps we're going to find the lions on a buffalo when it gets a little bit cooler. But this seems to be like a beautiful stallion standing proud and tall, munching away. Now, slightly separated from the rest of the herd, but that's okay. I think he deserves a bit of alone time every now and then as well. Here he goes, having a little look at us, but you can see how beautiful and stocky he is. He is in his prime at the moment. Very big neck, mane standing up nice and straight, and of course, complete with big shoulders and a lovely hindquarter. He would make a very nice show pony, actually. But it's best that he stays out here in the wild, of course. And that's one of the things. Zebras do not enjoy being domesticated. They prefer it out here. They kick and bite 10 times worse than a pony. But they're lovely. And that's something I haven't seen too much of. Well, I've just been thinking about all the buffalo that the lions have caught over the past few weeks, and it's just been absolutely incredible how they are really making use of all the buffalo that are around at the moment. Now, in case you were concerned about the animals, especially 2 mornings ago when we found the 2 dead buffalo, It is definitely because of the drought. I was chatting to a few people down in the Southern Sand and they say that it's the same thing. The buffalo, unfortunately, just can't take it anymore. And they are also dying down in the south. They say almost around every corner there are dead buffalo. But remember, this is very important. As sad as what it is, this is nature. These types of things do happen, and it's very good to try and keep the populations in check. It's the same thing with mange and diseases, canine distemper, whatever it may be. It can't only just be the herbivores that suffer, and there needs to be a means to try and control the predator populations, and that of course comes in the form of diseases, which is sad, but it is one of those things. Now we see the zebra going to the restroom. Perhaps we should sit here and wait for 20 minutes to see if there are any dung beetles that are going to come and join, but unfortunately it's just a little bit too far off the road. But that's a theory I've always wanted to test, to see exactly how long after an animal has defecated will it take the dung beetles to sort of arrive and spot it. But let's go up a little bit further. There's a couple more zebra and I think some impala, and I can just hear a few little cracks up ahead sort of from the trees. Maybe it is just the impala and zebra walking around, but let's just poke our noses up ahead. And I'm quite enjoying this little bumble. It's actually really refreshing now. I think out of all the days, it was perfect that it started off nice and hot, and it's just gradually cooled. And I think it might even end with me perhaps putting on a rain jacket. These clouds are looking quite daunting and it's getting nice and dark. And there's another zebra. Hello, Zebby. Listening to what I'm about to say. No, don't worry, I won't talk too much nonsense this afternoon. Just a little bit. And it's also so unique on the Birchall zebra how they're not exactly just black and white, of course, that shadow stripe. But what I really love is that sort of rust color that shadow stripe brings to their entire body, unlike sort of the Cape Mountain zebra or any other species with sort of just solid black and white stripes. I quite like it. There's quite a bit of character on the body of a Birchall zebra. They're all feeding happily here, but like I said, it is sad to see that the grass is now finished and they're having to resort to moving off into the denser areas again to look for grass that hasn't been eaten. Hello, Lauren from Australia. You're wondering if zebras ever or can ever have twins. Of course, they can indeed, very much like horses, but it's not very common out here. And if she does, or if the mare does have two foals, I think that would be a jolly tough job, especially when you've got lots of lions and hyenas and, of course, leopards. A big male leopard could easily take a zebra foal. And you can imagine it's hard enough trying to keep tabs on one foal or one baby. Now imagine if you've got two of them. It also put a lot more pressure on her. She'd have to start eating almost double the amount in order to produce enough milk. And at times like these, that can be quite stressful. So you may even see that unfortunately one of the foals, if they were to be twins, that maybe wouldn't make it, just purely because there is not enough sustenance around for mom to keep producing lots and lots of milk. And we know what little babies are like, humans and of course animals. They are gutsy little things. Eating machines. That's all they do. Eat and poop. And that's it. Until they start developing their personality and all those amazing things that comes with it. And off they go. But I think let's carry on up ahead. The zebra also now disappearing into the thicket. Look, just behind a shrub where we can't see them too much. But let's carry on a little bit further ahead. Our goal is to end up around Sydney's Dam. We want to have a look at Bivell's Hook Dam, and then we want to go and find a new area to have a look and see if we can't get a little shot. It may be tricky to get a shot of the grass though this evening, so if we don't do it this evening because it's getting dark, I will remember and we'll do it tomorrow morning. But let's go back across and see how Byron is doing on this lovely afternoon.
We're searching, that's what we're doing, Taylor. We're having a look around. There's a lot of antelope around here, just all impala scattered around in front of us. You see them just moving around. I haven't found anything else yet. I'm very surprised. No sign of any leopard activity this morning or this afternoon. And I do think what's possibly happened is maybe the leopards have managed to kill something in the evening. You know, after with that rain, a lot of the predators rely on the rain for hunting because then it's easier to stalk and look or potentially hunt any prey. Lions do use the rain, and especially leopards. A lot of the time after rainstorms, I've found kills in animals like leopard or lion. I think maybe what happened is if they did make a kill during that storm, the storm would have also have washed away all their tracks. So it's very difficult for us to then find out where those leopards are or where the predators are. Hang on. Ah, some vultures on the ground. I think we know what that was. There was, this is the area that the lions killed that buffalo yesterday. So there's a few, probably some remains around there. I'm trying to think, it's just off-road. We do need to be a little bit sensitive with off-roading at the moment, purely because it is still quite dry and we usually only off-road for certain animals and lions. Those vultures, you know, they're just taking off. That's exactly that. It's that old buffalo carcass that the lions came across yesterday. That's exactly what it was. This is where Taylor was yesterday morning. She was with that old buffalo carcass, but I see those vultures have all just taken off there now. Also, don't want to disturb them if they are feeding. Nice to see them on the ground. Well spotted. There's one still down there. If we had to drive in there now, we'd probably chase them off. And we don't want to do that. So this is one of the carcasses. There's been a lot of carcasses around the last day or two. But it is quite thick through there now anyway. I don't think we'd be able to get in there. I know Taylor had one carcass this morning with a lot of vulture activity. I think that's not too far from this area either. But those vultures, most of them just took off now again. Yeah, so I think yesterday, if I'm not mistaken, there were three or four different buffalo carcasses from these lions, which is incredible. They came across a herd and they hunted one after another. It really was amazing. Just shows you how opportunistic they can be. And they do it purely because it's instinct. They don't know when they're going to get the next meal. So if food is readily available, they will go out and hunt. A lot of impala around here. So Donna has asked us a question, and Donna would like to know, what is the cat sighting record, big cat sighting record at the moment for Safari Live? And I think it is 48 days solid of seeing lions on Safari Live. Or any big cat, but big cats in general, lion or leopard, but 48 days every day I know for a fact for lions, which is incredible. That really is amazing. So we've been very fortunate. All right, let's see what else we can find. Time we've got to keep scanning. Sometimes quite tricky, and you know, I always say, I'm sure over the years, my guiding experience over the years I've been guiding, I'm sure I've missed a lot, because sometimes it's just almost impossible to see everything. Uh, I'm going, myself and Eggsy are going to carry on scanning and hopefully find something soon. We're heading towards one of the big dams, Biffles Hook Dam, so maybe we get something there. While I do that, let's get an update from Taylor and see where she is.
Now, I'm looking for a termite mound. I found a termite mound, but I'm going to climb it and I'm going to stand on the top of it now. Rebecca, can I just have that termite question once more? I just want to double check before I jump out. Rebecca's just going to read me a question about termites very quickly. There we go. Off I go, out I jump with everything. You almost got me falling out of the vehicle. I was being attacked by a variety of things. But now let me try and climb this termite mound. Whew. It's a big one. And I went running today and did squats and all sorts of things. And my legs are very stiff. But we'll get up. Dun, 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 dun. I feel like a champion right now. Honestly, I feel on top of the world. You won't believe how much I can see from up here. No wonder the kudu and all sorts of things and the leopards come up to the top of the termite mounds to have a look and scan around. But I'm going to take a seat. Oh, it's a bit soft. Now, we had a question earlier, and now my brain has gone all boggly after climbing up here. Let me take a seat, though. But it was about, if I wonder if any of the termite mounds are perhaps going to explode this afternoon. Now, I hope so. I'm hoping in the next few days. But we'll try not to get too excited because I know that I've been waiting for the last 2 months now to see this. But I have to tell you that, sorry, just listening. Thought I heard something, but it's obviously not anything. I did see a giraffe in the distance. Maybe it was that. We did see lots of ants this morning, little ant alates flying around of various species. So that was quite nice that they managed to release those. But nothing happening just here, unfortunately. It seems to be dormant, this mound, but perhaps it's active below the surface. Ooh. Now, I'm taking deep breaths because I didn't realize how soft the soil was here. Normally the termite mounds are like concrete, but let me jump and run round the corner. Woo! Back. And back we go. Into the termite, and not into the termite mound. My goodness, what is wrong with me? My brain is officially fried from all this heat. But let's carry on. Now, I keep getting distracted because one of our plans, and I very quickly need to readjust all the things that I'm sitting on. There we go. That feels a little bit better. Is that we want to go across. And I will eventually get to a place if we think we've got enough light for this afternoon to also do the comparison of the grasses. But we'll see how that goes. Oh, here's a bird we haven't said hello to for quite some time on top of that cluster leaf. And it's definitely one we didn't get to stop at today. And just a quick glimpse, it has raced off chasing somebody else. Very typical of the fork-tailed drongo. They're quite aggressive, and when anybody comes into their territory, well, they don't take lightly to it, I'm afraid. But never mind, we can continue, and I am going to keep an eye out for the termite mound, so I'm probably going to stop and do a lot of jumping out today, just double checking, making sure if we can see any. James Richard, it sounds like you know the answer to this one already. He wants to know which insect that is not a butterfly or a moth has the largest wingspan. I'm not sure. Now, I wonder if it's perhaps not one of the praying mantises. I know you can get really big praying mantids, but off the top of my head, I can't even think who is the largest if it's not a butterfly or a moth. We've got some more zebras. I'm going to go with something like something random. You've caught me off guard here, but I'm sure that you'll be able to find out that question, but I would go with something like a praying mantis. I think people underestimate the size of a praying mantis. Of it. It would be nice if some of you actually have a look without Googling, and or just have a guess and see what you think. The answer to James Richard's question is what insect do you think is the largest wingspan with other than a butterfly and of course a moth? Now, Monique, we were chatting about termite mounds and I was out hopping around doing all sorts of crazy things and you were wondering, what am I talking about when I say explosion of the termite mound? Now, normally once a year, usually as the first rains or the second rains arrive, it depends on how much rain you get. And we had a decent amount for the first time. And what happens is that those princes and princesses of the termites, of the ants, will then be released in order to go and start and make a colony for themselves. And when we say explosion, it's because they all come out of the termite mound at once, and you almost can't see any ground. It's just wriggling little termites. Some of them are not actually too small, they're quite large, in fact. And because termites are such a good source of protein, so many different animals come out to eat them, and that's what I'm really excited about, is to see the frogs, the snakes, the owls, and even, oh, I just thought, I think I can hear a few frogs croaking in the distance, and even things like African civets, genets, which we don't always see, or when we see them, we only see a glimpse of them. They even come around and become quite relaxed when they're in a feeding frenzy on top of a mound, trying to gut as many termites as they can. That is really quite special to see. Now, Lauren, you're wondering if termites are nocturnal. They are indeed, and that's because of their very sensitive exoskeleton. Unfortunately, it cannot handle the heat of the sun. So they normally come out at night, also work as hard as they can, but they do carry on working inside the mound during the heat of the day. And sometimes at night they even put up little temporary shelters, sort of over a section of vegetation that they want to take back to the mound. And then they're able to continue working throughout the day. Now, one thing we're going to do tonight before we end the show, though, is we're going to go and sit at a dam and hopefully listen to the array of frogs that I'm sure we will hear. Isn't that going to be quite exciting? You can remember when we did the safari marathons, we had a bit of rain and we got to hear the beautiful choruses of all the different frogs. Having a little groom. Almost forgot we were watching the zebra, chatting so much about termites. But of course, they're right here, carrying on with their day. Not even too bothered by us at all. We're having better luck with the zebras today. They don't seem to be racing away like they normally do. I can't say the same for the impala, though. One day the impala will like me. But for now, it seems as though it's not going to be today, I'm afraid. So we've had a few different answers coming through, from praying mantis agreeing with me to James Richard's question, and we've had tarantula. Now, Jason, I don't know if tarantula could be one of the answers. The only reason being is because a tarantula wasp. Sorry, Rebecca, I only caught the tarantula part. Then, of course, Jason, it can be a tarantula wasp. That's a good guess. There were a couple of others as well. Now I wonder, James Richard, I wonder if you could let us all know, though, what the actual answer is to that question. I'm sure it's a very interesting fact, that. And it will definitely be going into the notebook now. Seems as though Byron's got a few tricks up his sleeve this afternoon. Why don't you jump onto the back of his vehicle and see what he's got?
And tricks. I don't have any tricks up my sleeve this afternoon, but we just got to Buffleshoek Dam and just have a look at how full it is. Those of you who missed it this morning, from all that rain we had last night, it really is incredible. Look at that. That's amazing, just from one really big storm. So it's obviously got a very good catchment area. Just trying to have a look and see what... there's some Egyptian geese at the edge of the water, just to the right. There we go. Really are beautiful birds, the Egyptian geese. They are found everywhere. Oh, no animals down here drinking though. I know Taylor was asked a question regarding the wingspan of insects and which insect has the largest wingspan other than a butterfly or a moth. Now, if I think about it, insects that I know that do have really long wingspans, one of them are dragonflies. Dragonflies have got very long wingspans for the size of their body. So I'm sure it's all relative in terms of the actual size of the body. So dragonflies, and then locusts. Locusts have got huge wingspans, especially the larger locusts. When they're swarming, their wingspans are quite large. So my guess would be perhaps one of those, but we'll sit and maybe discuss it this evening and see if we can't find out exactly. It's a good question. Never really thought of it, but my guess would possibly be one of those two species of insect. But it is interesting, and there's maybe something else we haven't thought of yet. I think let's carry on and see what else we can find. Not much happening at the dam at the moment. Well, the sun is sneaking through. I think we're going to have a beautiful sunset because there's still a lot of cloud cover around. So in the next hour or so, actually half an hour, 45 minutes. And Taylor's got something else she'd like to show you, something interesting apparently.
While we were sitting with the zebra, I could hear some strange noises going in the distance on this little tree. And you can see an insect sitting on this branch. Now, I have my suspicions. I think it's a cicada that we're looking at. I'm not sure which one, but you can see those big beady eyes. And of course, it's almost transparent wings, which is quite typical of a cicada. Now, sometimes you can find cicadas that are beautiful and so colorful, with reds and greens and yellows and all sorts of amazing colors on it. But this one seems to be quite sort of playing in colors. And it's quite amazing. Now, these are incredible insects. They make lots and lots of noise. And I know that you've probably heard it a couple of times where we've sat quietly and we've asked you to turn your volume up as loud as it can on a nice summer's evening when the cicadas are in full sort of blown chorus singing, just madness, lots and lots of noise. And that can reach up to about 130 decibels or so. And that's quite loud. That would probably make you want to do something along those lines. But I thought that was quite nice. I haven't seen a cicada in ages. We shall leave it alone and let it enjoy its day. I think it probably doesn't even suspect that we spotted it. And they're normally insects that are quite hard to find. You don't actually see them around all the time. We've got lots and lots of zebras everywhere again. It seems as though everywhere we go, we find a zebra. Hello. You're very calm as well. And we always seem to see, though, when the food is sort of not as abundant as it has been, the animals start to relax a little bit more around us, and I think it's because they just can't be bothered to move and race away from us unnecessarily and exhaust themselves and burn off calories that are vital to them. We see it especially with the warthogs. I think I was saying yesterday how when the drought is at its worst, the warthogs almost appear tame and will come right up to you, sort of within a meter or two of you, if it means that it's going to eat some grass. It's quite nice for us, of course, to have a few pictures and that type of thing, but we do hope that there's more rain coming. But again, like, I'm not too worried now that we had 20 mils of rain, because that's going to bring good covering of grass over the next few weeks. Well, the wind's starting to pick up now, so that's good. It means it's hopefully going to blow some of the clouds in a little bit quicker. You can see them starting to build up in the distance. See that wall of clouds coming in from the west. Hopefully it's going to come straight towards us. Isn't that beautiful though? I think it's going to be another spectacular sunset tonight. Well done, Holly Wilson, who has given us the answer to the question. So apparently it seems to be a Dobson fly, which comes from China. That's quite amazing. I don't even know what a Dobson fly is. I'm actually going to have a little look myself, but I can imagine it must be ginormous. And apparently it has a wingspan of about 21 centimeters. Isn't that massive? Did anybody else guess that? I wasn't even close. I guessed praying mantis. But thanks for that. That was really, really a great question that came through, and it's so nice to have all of you interacting, having little debates and chatting like this, and together we can all learn lots and of course lots of different things. So that's a new fact that's going in the brown notebook as soon as I can, but we're going to continue. Let's go back across to Byron and see what's happening down that end of the world.
We haven't been able to find any leopard or sign of leopard this afternoon, but this is what a leopard would look like if it was laying across this branch or over this big tree stump. So they are incredible climbers, and I've managed to climb up onto this one. I'm not as good a tree climber as James is. I see a lot of holes in this tree at the moment. I hope there are no little scorpions hiding in there. So I took a chance, but that's what a leopard would look like if it was lying across a tree. So we're hopefully going to find one of those in the next few days. We haven't had too much luck with anything else. We are on our northern boundary and just having a good look around for any sign of animals that might have crossed. You never know. The temperature's cooled down quite a bit, so predators could possibly start getting a bit more active. And we might find out what the lions are up to. I know some other guys went and had a look and maybe try to get to them a little bit later if they've moved out of that drainage line where we saw them. It was very thick in there, but you never know, they could come out a little bit later. We heard them calling last night in the rain. Just having a good look at the tracks while we're driving. And Cheryl has just asked, because she has seen so many zebra around, or we have seen so many zebra around on drive, and why haven't we seen more lions hunting zebra? Because there are a lot of zebra around. So I think, Cheryl, one of the main reasons is the zebras seem to still be in fairly good condition, so they're still healthy enough to be able to run away a lot quicker. The buffalo have been struggling because of the drought, because they need a lot of food to keep those massive massive bodies of theirs going. And I think because also there have been a lot of buffalo herds moving through the area and looking for water, it's been a bit easier for the lions hunting the buffalo. Possibly. That would be my theory, but I'm not too sure. It's a very good question. But that would be my theory, is that the buffalo just are a little bit weaker than the zebra, and it's a bit easier to hunt the buffalo at the moment. Let's see what else we can find. As I was saying, we heard those lions calling last night during the storm. Actually, they were calling, which was very interesting. And I wonder if tonight, if we're lucky, maybe we hear these lions calling again. They're not too far from camp, so
Perhaps we are lucky. It's always wonderful. It's probably one of my favorite sounds in the bush, to hear lions roar, especially if you're able to get very close to them. It's absolutely incredible. We've got a question from Safari Girl, and Safari Girl would like to know, what is my favorite part of this job, of guiding, and what is my favorite animal? So I would have to say my favorite animal is a honey badger. And even though I haven't seen one in, I think, almost 3 years, I haven't been able to see a honey badger. It's not without trying, they've just always eluded me. And my second favorite would definitely be the elephant. I love elephant. And then why do I love this job so much? Well, for one thing, every day is different. We never know what we're going to see out here. And speaking of which, I just caught a glimpse of a warthog, but it's run away. It seems to be running off into the thicket line. It's gone, unfortunately. Just caught a glimpse of a warthog. I think because every day is so different, and you never know what you're going to see or what you're going to experience. And one of the other things I really love about my job is interaction with people and being able to take people on safari, show them around, and hopefully teach them a little bit about nature and about Africa. And that's definitely why I love doing what I do. I really do enjoy it. Louisa has asked an interesting question. Louisa would like to know, what is the most unusual animal behavior I have ever witnessed? Louisa, I'm trying to think. Just off the top of my head, one that pops into mind now is, we were speaking about leopard earlier, and I was very fortunate. I've worked in the Sabi Sands, well, at a lodge called Londolozi. I worked there for about 5 years, almost 6 years. And the leopard viewing within this entire area is very, very good. And down there, we were fortunate. I got to track and find and follow and see interaction between many, many different leopards. And one of the most interesting sightings that I can remember is we had a male and female leopard that were mating. So they were moving around together. And then what happened was the male was challenging another male for territory, another dominant male. So there were three of them together, and what happened was these two males began to fight, but very aggressive fighting. The female then just hung around on the outskirts and began to watch, and just keeping a distance so that she wasn't in harm's way. And then out of nowhere, another male who was also, it was just on the edge of his territory too, another male came into the area, and he sat back and watched. He didn't get involved though, but he also just watched the interaction between the two males that were fighting. So four big adult leopard all together in the same area. It was fascinating to see. I've never seen that again. It was very interesting, and that's probably one of the more interesting sightings I've had. Trying to think what else. I was very fortunate, speaking about honey badger, 1 year. There's a giraffe. Hang on. Let's see if we can see. Can you get it through there? Let me see a little bit forward, maybe. It's a bit tricky. Maybe through there. Slightly positioning the vehicle. There we go. Eggs has got it there. Look at that. Just the beautiful giraffe. Big male, big old male. Look at that skull, the head. You can see the calcification around his head. That's a very, very old male. Bertus, good afternoon to you. Bertus is a new viewer, so welcome on Safari Live. Bertus would like to know, how long do giraffes sleep in a day?
and do they sleep standing up? So Bertha's giraffe and most animals, they do rest. They don't necessarily sleep like we sleep. If the giraffe do end up sleeping properly, it will be for very short periods of time, because they cannot afford to drop their guard. All these animals have to constantly be aware of what's around them. So they'll rest, and they will lie down to rest, but the giraffe always keep their heads held up high, always keep their necks up, and they lie on their stomachs, and they'll rest that way. And then later on, they'll get up and start moving again. This could be for anywhere between 1 and 4 hours a day. So not a lot, but they don't necessarily sleep like we sleep. None of these animals do. You can imagine impala always have to be awake and aware of what's going around them. They do rest, however, so they will lie down, but they'll still be aware and alert. Even those lions, we saw them sleeping earlier, but they are still completely aware of what's going on around them. I mentioned how I'd been watching a pride of lions on a number of occasions, sleeping or resting next to in a thicket, and an impala or different antelope came wandering through, and within seconds these lions were up and they managed to kill the impala. So it just shows you that even though they look asleep, they're still completely aware of what's going on around them. Don't forget, everybody, this is a live safari, so what we are seeing, you are seeing immediately back home. There's no editing or anything. And don't forget, you can send your questions and comments through to us, either via Twitter, hashtag SafariLive, or email questions at wildearth.tv. And we'll gladly answer your questions, or we'll try our best to answer them. Scanning the trees carefully for any sign of a leopard. It's a beautiful afternoon. As I said, there's still quite a lot of cloud cover. Well, it's faded a little bit, but still in the west. And I think we're going to have a beautiful sunset. Look at that. That is lovely. So I'm sure we're going to have a great sunset. Some buffalo just off to the left. Here we go. These look like some old bulls, a bachelor herd. That's quite a big male, that. Look at the boss, all that horn structure. It's known as the boss. Very, very thick. And these animals are ones that I must admit I least enjoy walking into them when we are on foot and around, because they can be quite unpredictable, these old buffalo bulls, and they have the reputation of being quite aggressive. But I think again it's purely because they feel threatened, and the only way they know how to defend themselves is to potentially see off the threat or the danger. They do that with lions. I mean, I've seen a number of times of lions trying to hunt buffalo, and the buffalo turn around and end up chasing the lions off, especially these big males. But that's interesting. Buffalo are meant to be grazers, which means they eat grass, but because of the drought and the dry conditions, these buffalo are browsing. See, they're eating leaves off the trees. Well, they're basically mixing between the two, grass, whatever grass they can find, and some of the leaves. So it just shows you how
The drought has affected these animals, and the behavior has changed slightly because of it. But it also shows how animals have the ability to adapt. You can see that every little bit of grass the buffalo can get. Oh, not much around. You can see there very small little tufts. Very peaceful here at the moment. Just hear the buffalo moving, some of them moving through the trees, breaking some little sticks and twigs while they're walking. It's often good just to stop and listen like this at times, because you can also be alerted to predators in the area or nearby from alarm calls from different animals. A lot of animals have got different alarm calls for when they see any predators. Monkeys and baboons are great because they give off very loud alarm calls, and you've got a pretty good chance of finding a predator if you're able to see where those monkeys and baboons are looking, because their eyesight is so very, very good. And the amount of times I've found predators because of their alarm calls, I can't even tell you. And then also different antelope species have alarm calls, and they will alert each other. And the reason they do that is for safety, to alert each other, let each other know that there is danger around, they need to be aware, and that they can move out of the area where the predator is. So it's not a bad thing to often stop and just listen in the bush. And here, if you can't hear some of those alarm calls or any sign that there might be something around. I'm going to continue our search for anything else. And Taylor's got a bird in a nest.
Look at this, you're just catching the male of the magpie shrike, feeding Mrs. Magpie Shrike on the right. So he's been working hard for the past couple of days, and he's going to continue. So he's gone now in search of something else to eat. Let's see if there's any chicks inside here. Oh, look at that, look at this. They look like they're two little chicks. Well done, Mr. and Mrs. Magpie Shrike. Your babies have hatched. That is amazing. I just said to Brian, I was like, I wonder if there are any chicks. We both thought it looked like she was sitting a little bit higher up than what she normally is. Oh my goodness. That was incredible. The first glimpse of Mr. and Mrs. Magpie Shrike's little chicks. I only saw two from what I could see. Brian, did you see any more? Only, it looks like it could only be two. Maybe there's still another egg or so. I don't know if you spotted that they didn't have any feathers on them, and it looks like their eyes were still closed. So I reckon that they're probably only a few days old, maybe a day or two. We were here two mornings ago, and she definitely didn't have any chicks, because we watched Mr. Magpie Shrike come through, and he fed the female, and she ate it. She didn't pass it on. That was amazing. Now, Mr. Magpie Shrike is going to have to work very, very hard just until these little ones develop some feathers and they're able to be left in the nest unattended. And then Mom will go off and start helping to feed the chicks too. It's obviously very difficult for one to do all the work. That was absolutely beautiful. I'm so happy that we managed to see that. Wasn't that spectacular? Now, something else that is spectacular that I want to show you, I'm going to try and roll back very quickly, is look at what is developing. Can you see that? I now don't think we're going to really get a sunset at all this evening. Sorry, I'm just trying to get into gear there. We don't roll away. But that cloud is creeping over. Isn't that beautiful? lovely light coming off the tops of the clouds. All those crepuscular rays. Absolutely stunning. Now let's hope we're going to see some lightning building up before we have to end the show a little bit later. Won't that be exciting to actually watch the development of a storm come in from start to finish? It'll be really exciting. I really cannot believe we got to see those magpie shrike chicks. Now let's quickly try and get another look at the magpie shrikes, just in case that male comes back. I'm now quite keen to spend a little bit of time. Is that all right, Brian? A little bit further forward. Here we go. There's a tiny little gap here. Would you like me to go try and go a little bit further? Oh, no, there we go. That's all right. Here we go. He's back again. Working very hard. Now, that's not a big, as big of a, there we go. Hopefully, this mother is now feeding those chicks turn by turn. Look at them, proud parents that they have were able to hatch two of those chicks. Now, Debbie from Vancouver, you're wondering if cuckoos ever use the magpie shrikes as sort of hosts. I haven't heard of it, and I'm very quickly just double checking. As far as I'm aware, they aren't sort of parasitized by any of the cuckoos. Now, I'm just double checking that I was correct, and if I was indeed. So lucky for them, they're actually going to have two little magpie shrikes and not any imposters. Now, there's various techniques that the cuckoos will do, though, to take over a nest, which it'll be host dependent. So some of those techniques are, they will sort of, oh, there we go, something else. He's doing a sterling job. What is he catching? It looks like little termites or something. Is it a little termite or ant of some sort? I'm trying to have a look. It's quite difficult to make out what was in the beak of the mother. Yeah, the little ones look like they're full. Nobody's stuck there. Here we go. Three. There's three chicks. Oh, wow. That was number three. So sorry, Debbie. I keep getting distracted, but this is just absolutely so beautiful to witness the parental care of the magpie shrikes. So I was saying that some of the different techniques, it will depend on the host and then, of course, the species of the cuckoo. Sometimes the cuckoos will lay their eggs in the nest and kick the other eggs out themselves, or the chicks will hatch and they will push the other eggs out of the nest themselves. They're often born with concave backs, which allows them to sort of scoop the nest, the egg up onto their underdeveloped wings, and then that concave back, of course, helps, and then they're able to shove it out of the nest. Otherwise, they also practice siblicide, where they will unfortunately kill off the actual host chicks. I think it's just pretty amazing, though, that even though they don't look the same, the cuckoo and the host don't look the same as they start to get older, that mother has just got a serious sort of maternal need to raise that chick, and she doesn't care. It was in her nest. It must be hers, and she's going to look after it, regardless of its abnormal looks compared to the other magpie shrikes. Now, what we might see, and I'm so happy that we stumbled across this magpie shrike nest so we can watch the story grow now. Most likely the chicks from Mr. and Mrs. Magpie Shrike's previous egg-laying conundrum from last year, once they would have hatched, and I'm sure they'll be in the area. Often the previous brood will help feed the new brood that comes through. So these two little chicks these three little chicks, we saw that there were three now, will definitely have some helping hands when they fledge the nest. And that's typically why we see them in sort of big groups. It's not necessarily that they are cooperative breeders in the sense that the others don't breed, but it's normally the juveniles that are helping raise the new chicks. Look at that. They're getting lots of food before you know it. These little chicks are going to be big and strong. There you go. Mom having a little bit for herself, and she rightfully deserves that. And they need to feed all the time. Those little things are going to be hungry, and they won't say no to food. They need to eat as much as they can. Andreen, I'm not entirely sure how to answer this question. You want to know what on the earth are they feeding the chicks? I'm not sure. I tried to have a little look. To me, they almost look like termites, perhaps maybe harvested termites, maybe even the large fungus-growing termites. We'll try and have a look again, seeing as this male is doing such a good job at bringing back all the food. But maybe even some grasshoppers. Though grasshoppers are quite easy to sort of see them with their legs, and you know, they're very typical grasshopper shape. But to me, they look like termites. But he looks like he's going to come back again. I can see him just up on the dead tree behind us, scouring around. So perhaps he's coming back in again to drop off something else, and then maybe this time we'll have an opportunity to have a closer look. What do you think that these chicks are being fed? Maybe you had a better look than I did, or were able to pause the screen, maybe take a screenshot of it, and then we can zoom in and have a look. And if I'm wrong, please let me know. Maybe it was something completely different. It could have been a cockroach or anything along those lines. They mainly eat insects, but occasionally they'll eat fruit too, but it's not a common part of their diet. Here he comes, he's back in again. He's just further down below her. You can see his tail flapping in the wind. Well, the wind's really picking up. They're both chatting to each other. There's another tiny little insect that you saw. I didn't see what that was. That was quite small. That could have been an ant. Like I said, they'll virtually catch any insect that they can. A butterfly, a moth, a caterpillar, a worm, a maggot, anything along those lines. And those little ones will happily devour whatever they are given. But that was, I'm just completely blown away. Wasn't that fantastic? But I think we're going to leave Mr. and Mrs. Magpie Shrike now to carry on with their babysitting duties, and it's quite a difficult one. I think that they are fantastic for being able to care for so many chicks, and that male is doing a sterling job in making sure that his lovely wife and his children are well fed. We're going to carry on and see what else we can find. And let's go back across to Byron and, of course, Eggsy, who's also out on drive.
So I haven't found anything yet, but how amazing was that sighting with that magpie shrikes? That is so great. We haven't had too much luck. Or more luck. I mean, a good look around, but that's how it goes sometimes, you know, and that's one of the joys of being out here, is you never know what you're going to see, and it's not always a guarantee. You need to remember that it takes a lot of time and effort finding these animals, and that also just allows us to appreciate the sightings so much more when we do see them. But let's see what we can find. You never know. As I always say, it's too soon to panic. And I know Taylor said she doesn't think we're going to get much of a sunset, and I think you might be right. Because the sun has dipped behind the clouds, although I'm still hoping. Maybe we get a few rays shooting through. On the ground over there, exit just over here. I just want to get out quickly and show you this. It's quite interesting. Oh, look at this. So I wasn't, we drove here yesterday and this definitely wasn't here. This looks like it's been created by termites, and it's very active. I can see tiny termites at the moment all around here, and that's because of the rain. So the termites are becoming more and more active now because of the moisture in the sky or in the air, and obviously all the moisture that's hit the ground. So this is brand new. This was built literally from probably from this morning during the course of the day. These termites have managed to bring all that soil out and build this little funnel right over here for this little entrance to a potential termite mound, but I don't think this is going to get very, very big, but at least we know there is a termite colony under here. I'm trying to see, it's completely hollow. I don't want to touch it. It's still very, very soft and brittle because it is still new. So I'm not going to touch it because I don't want to break it. But I can see a few little tiny, tiny termites wandering around here. Oh, that's great. So that's interesting. It's amazing how quickly they're able to build these little funnels and get that soil out of the ground. I know Taylor spoke about some termites earlier, and alates, those are the winged termites, the ones that start the colonies usually when they do move or when they do leave the colony that they were in. They will go off and start another colony, and they're the winged termites. Let's make sure I miss that. There we go. Really great if you're able to find some of the larger active termite mounds. You get bigger termites. There's also a number of different species of termites too. There's not just one species. Oh, here we go. There's a nice active termite mound. This is great. It looks like some soldiers out there. Let me just reposition. Make sure you can have a look at this. This is great. I'll see if I can get some for you. There we go. All right. Awesome. Let me jump out here quickly. Oh, this is fantastic. This is a very, very active termite mound. And I'm going to see if I can just get one termite for you. I don't want to disturb them too much. But just for you to have a look, one of the soldiers. The thing is, they've got very, very big pincers and they can bite. So I don't want to pick one up and it ends up biting me viciously. Let's just have a look here. They're all hiding. I don't know how closely you can zoom. Just, all right. Well, Eggsy says pretty close. Let's see. Come on. Again, this is all new. This whole section over here, of this termite mound, is all new. So this is active. And all these little soldiers are out protecting the termite mound. So from any potential predators that come through that might want to feed on them or on the termites or on the colony, these soldiers are out with their pincers. They also secrete a formic acid of sorts, which will irritate whatever is trying to feed on them. And they will come out and they will bite whatever it is. Let's see. All seem to be hiding now. They're just right in the back. There aren't any that have come out, but they are around here. These beautiful red little termites. Let's see. Like I said, I don't want to disturb the termites too much or cause them any harm. It's very difficult. I won't be able to get one out there for you now. But they are all there. But that's a nice active termite mound with the big soldiers at the entrances to all these little tunnels and these chimneys that run through the entire termite mound. And that's obviously to regulate the temperature. And with all the moisture around at the moment, they're probably allowing air to flow through and they're able to build and extend their termite mound because there is moisture. So that is really, really great. Let me just plug in again. There you go. I'm not sure if you got to see one or two of them. Not really. Oh, it's a bit difficult. They're not very big. They're only about this size. So the soldiers, that's quite big for a termite though.
about that size with these big pincers. I was hoping to try and show you one on my hand, but like I said, I don't want to disturb the mound too much, irritate them. If one was out and walking about, I could have maybe picked him up quickly, but they were all right inside. Lucian has asked, can the termites eat, can people eat the termites? Yes, Lucian, people can eat termites, and a lot of people do, especially locals that maybe grew up in this area, you know, tribes when they were younger. People who lived in the bush, they will definitely eat termites. Very rich in protein, so it's a great food source. And Taylor seems to be enjoying the sunset. She says she's got a beautiful sky. Let's have a look.
This was just too beautiful to pass up. And I'm wondering if we're going to get the sun coming through that little gap in the clouds, or if it's just a little bit further west. And maybe we're going to miss it, but I just thought that this was such a beautiful shot. There's so many different types of clouds here. Cirrus clouds, cumulonimbus, a couple of course I've already said it. Sorry, I lost my thought on where I was going with the clouds. But nevertheless, there's lots of them here. And now it looks like it's clearing up a little bit. The sky is playing games with us this evening. But isn't that so beautiful, the different colors, the yellows, the oranges, the blues? It's stunning. Hello, Timothy Howard. You want to know what is the weather like over here? Now, currently we're in October, as you know, because that's I think the same all over the world. I don't know why I had to remind myself about that. But yes, we are in spring at the moment indeed. We're coming to the end of spring though, and sort of November will be the last month of spring, and then we hit December and we're into the hot summer. Though some of these days it feels as though summer has indeed arrived already. I'm just looking into the distance. We've got a vehicle coming up, so we're going to have to turn around very quickly. And we're still trying to get to Biffles Hook Dam, but we're not far now. We're sort of almost on schedule. So I'm just going to quickly reverse over here, turn around, and then we're going to carry on to Biffles Hook Dam. Yeah. Right, let's carry on. Now, I don't know what we're going to find at Biffles Hook Dam. I just thought it would be nice to show Brian how full it is. Like I said, it's the fullest that I've seen it since I've been here. I thought it was quite spectacular. I think it looked like a lake this morning, especially with those Egyptian geese that were quite happily wading away and having a great morning breakfast. I wonder if they're still around. I'm sure that they're a permanent pair in that area. We're just going to go through a little dip and then we will soon be at Biffles Hook. Now, in a lot of the watering holes, I'm going to show you something in this little pan. I sometimes get quite excited and a little bit confused, but have a look over here. I'm going to go further forward. Look at that big thing sitting in the watering hole. Don't get too excited, it's not a crocodile, but sometimes these fallen logs do look like crocodiles, and I know that Shani was wondering if we do see any crocodiles or alligators. Let me quickly pull off the road. I've just got a vehicle behind me, and then we will carry on chatting. We do that. And now they're able to pass by us in peace and carry on with their day. We know that I'm not the fastest of the drivers. I seem to crawl along sometimes. Now, Shani, I haven't seen any sign of a crocodile, not even a footprint or anything since I've been up here. Now, it is possible, of course. It's obviously a little bit more common where you have larger river systems. So when I was down in the Southern Sand, we had the Sabi River. There were crocodiles in there all the time. And when we would get lots and lots of rain in the smaller rivers like the Msuklu and the Tsovatlatla and all those strange named rivers, when they would fill up and flow, then we'd often, quite often see quite a bit of crocodile activity. There even used to be one crocodile that would bask in the sun, especially, like I said, after rain. And quite close to my room, you'd walk outside thinking and hadn't seen any crocodiles for months and months. And the next minute, you hear the scurrying of the leaves and off down, and a big, obviously a big splash that would go with that. And then this big crocodile that we completely miss will be sitting sort of basking in the sun and would dive down straight into the water. But we always err on the side of caution. We always have a look. Now, especially if you are walking around, never mind just the hippos, those crocodiles that can sit on the bottom of the water and look completely invisible. Well, you wouldn't want to be surprised by one of them. So you'll see, if any of us do approach a watering hole, we'll be like the zebras. We'll stop and we'll have a look for a little bit and watch, make sure we don't see any bubbles that are sort of bigger bubbles than what a catfish or anything could produce. And of course, then you go up and you have a look, but you keep an eye out. Now, crocodiles are actually scary things, and they're highly intelligent. And one of the reasons why I think that they're pretty scary, and we saw this in Zambia, is that they are creatures of habit and they like to sit and watch their prey. So if you go and you use the same fishing spot off the side of a bank, a specific bank, on a regular basis, those crocodiles will figure that out. And eventually they'll start lurking around and going to those areas. And that's why you've got to be so careful when you were being on the sort of the dangerous side of fishing, not in a boat or anything like that. And you would have to make sure that you change your spot up regularly. That was all the first advice that the locals gave me when I was up there for a very short stint, was be careful of the crocodiles and don't fish in the same spot. Obviously, all the fishing that we did there, though, was all catch and release. But it was such a beautiful place. Now we're coming around the corner towards Buffleshoek Dam. We're not too far, just about a minute or two away. What is that? I'm just checking what is up in the tree. It's probably nothing. No. Now, I'm going to try and repeat the question that Rebecca just whispered into my ear amongst all the giggles. See, it's not just the presenters that get tongue-tied every now and then, but the directors in final control, sometimes the tongue just loves to stick onto the palate and it's almost impossible to make out what they're saying, which provides a lot of entertainment. But Roger, you're wondering if there are any animals in this area that have gone extinct. I'm sure there are. Nothing massive. We're very fortunate there. Obviously, lots of rhinos in this greater Kruger area. Not Roger, Richard, sorry. And I haven't seen anything. Maybe a couple of insects that I'm not aware of. That could be, definitely could have gone extinct. But just off of the top of my head, I can't think of anything. We've still got rhinos, we've got elephants, we've got the rest of the big five. We see some of the smaller things too. So it's maybe not that there are any that are extinct, but there's quite a few species that are quite shy. Numbers are sort of low that we need to look after. Now we've arrived at Buffleshoek Dam. Sorry, we're not, I think it should be called Lake Buffleshoek now, because that's what it sort of resembles. But I'm trying to think. Byron says, of course, the quagga, but I don't know if it even occurred up in this area. I'm just trying to think. I wasn't around to see the quagga, of course. So I suppose then you could also say things like dinosaurs and all those types of things. But I like I said, I wasn't around. I'm not even sure when the quagga went extinct, but it was a few years ago. And they would have been quite spectacular. If you're wondering what a quagga is, it looks like a combination between a donkey and a horse, something along those lines, if you can get your imagination going. Now you can see, even the water has subsided already since this morning. There's not as much of it that was around, but I suppose from all the animals coming to drink from it and bathe in it, and as well as it evaporating in this heat, it is going to drop very, very quickly. Are you impressed, Brian?
I am.
That's beautiful, isn't it?
Yes.
It's lovely. But nothing here, except I did very briefly see a blacksmith lapwing, but they are always regulars sort of around the watering holes. Right. Now what are we going to go and look for? We're just taking a lovely afternoon bumble, and it hasn't been a bad one. We're having so much luck already. Now we just need that leopard. I'm hanging around trying to listen on the radio to see if I can perhaps hear anything about a leopard. Of course, I'm looking for footprints, but I haven't seen anything just yet. But we will persevere and continue. And while we persevere and continue, let's go back to Byron.
I think Taylor and I have got the same idea this afternoon. We're also taking a wonderful afternoon bumble, as they call it. Just wandering through the bush and trying to see if anything pops up or presents itself for us. See, the wind has picked up a little bit. And the temperature has dropped. Let's see, there's a beautiful bird calling. Let's see if I can find it, the black-headed oriole. No, don't see it. I think it flew off. Usually with weather like this and that we had last night, you know, we've seen how all these small little creatures are becoming a lot more active. A lot of little beetles, all the dung beetles are out. We didn't see any yesterday or before that. So they've all come out. A lot of the tortoises are getting active. We saw the termites, they're all active. So that could also spark more activity from some of the nocturnal little animals. You never know, aardvark, pangolin, those types of animals which do occur in this area, they are quite rare and generally very nocturnal. You don't often see them at all, especially in these areas, but they do occur here. And maybe because of this rain and all the activity of food, all those little things they feed on, like those termites, you might get some activity and might end up finding some of them. You never know. Stranger things have happened in the bush. Wouldn't it be amazing to see a pangolin or an aardvark? So, just got a question from Dubs Racing, and they would like to know, are dung beetles endangered? No, not at all. We've got a very healthy dung beetle population, but there are many different species of dung beetles. I'm not exactly sure of the number, but there are many different species. And these dung beetles are categorized into three different categories. Do you see something? Thought Eggsy saw something. Dung beetles basically fall into three different categories. So you have got the rollers, some of the larger dung beetles that roll the ball of dung and roll it away, and they form those perfect little round balls. You also have got dwellers, which just live in the dung pile itself. They'll live there and feed on the dung. And then burrowers, which end up burrowing directly down underneath the ground from that dung pile and taking dung down there. And they'll feed on it and lay eggs in the dung. So the dung beetles play a very, very crucial role in the environment. So we just got a question from Kelly Ellie, I think, if I'm saying that correctly. And they would like to know, what is it that the dung beetles actually do with the dung? So Kelly Ellie, the dung beetles, what they do, and there's a nice bit of dung in front of us. Just quickly jump out and explain it over there at the pile of dung, because it is very interesting and they do play a very, very crucial role. So this is some old elephant dung, and I wonder if I can't find a dung beetle in here somewhere. This is basically just dry grass and plant material, so it's not actually very dirty, and I don't see any dung beetles here at the moment. But what they do is the dung beetles,
Basically what happens is the dung beetles feed on the dung. That is what they eat. And they'll roll the dung and carry it away. Some of the bigger rolling dung beetles, the ones that roll the dung away, they'll bury it, feed on the dung. But the most important thing is they actually lay their eggs in the dung. And the reason for that is as the eggs hatch, the larvae have something to feed on. They'll feed on the dung. So they basically get rid of all the dung that is around here, all the elephant, rhino, buffalo dung, many different antelope dung. So they play a crucial role. You can imagine if we didn't have dung beetles, this place would be littered with dung. So they really, really are important parts of our ecosystem that we have out here. I'm surprised we don't see any in there at the moment. So Kelly Ellie, I hope that answers your question, why or what dung beetles do and what they feed on, but they are very, very important. Melinda has asked an interesting question, and Melinda would like to know, do dung beetles suffer from parasites? Now Melinda, some of the larger dung beetles do have little parasites on them that will feed off, I think, some of the debris or the dung that is on them. But I don't think it's a case that they suffer from parasites, but they do carry tiny, tiny little parasites on their shells and around their body. So I have seen and I have read that they do have little tiny parasites around them, but I don't think it's a case of it affects them in any way or negatively. So Stephanie has asked, can dung beetles fly with the dung? Stephanie, I've never seen that and I don't think they do. They can fly, yes, but they don't fly and carry the dung. What they do is they only push the dung along the ground if they are rolling it away. They never fly with it. Hear some magpie shrikes calling in the distance. Again, I'm just thinking of the wonderful sighting Taylor had of those magpie shrikes in the nest with the chicks and the male feeding them. That's fantastic, and the female. Some starlings flying around. And continue driving around here. While I do that, let's get an update from Taylor and see where she is or what she's got.
We are currently driving on Mumba Road. Now, if you were watching this morning, I was itching to go and find out what happened to this carcass. Sorry, I just got distracted by the first buffalo carcass that is here. I'm going to go forward to our little spot. Now, the second carcass, I wasn't very squeaky. I wasn't, unfortunately, able to go in and have a look just because the ground was a bit too wet, but it is better now. And you can see it almost looks as though the vultures haven't even consumed any of it, but we know that they were on top of it this morning. But I think that there is just so much left of this carcass, they're going to be feeding on it for a few days, maybe till tomorrow. Now, that's something we're going to follow up on again in the morning, is perhaps come past here and see if the hyenas manage to pick up on it and eat it. But let's go across now. We're going to go all the way around. And I just want to double check what the quickest road is over here. Is we're going to go around and I'm going to go up to Drakensberg Road and we're going to try and get that second buffalo carcass that I wasn't able to head in and have a look at. And we'll see how much has been eaten, if any of it has been eaten at all, of course. Let's head around that way. Now it's getting a little bit chilly actually. It's very nice, of course, but the wind is now really gusting, which is really good news for us. And I can see some vultures in the distance up on a tree, so we'll try and have a little look at them. Maybe we can get a silhouette vulture shot this evening. Oh, I'm so sorry about the squeaky brakes, and I think we may get a silhouette vulture shot. Isn't that beautiful? Of course, the white-back vulture, which had been hanging around all day with a very full crop. And you see that big bulge coming out of its chest? It has obviously been consuming this buffalo and looks very much like I would on Christmas Day. But lovely. Well fed. Now they're going to look for a spot to roost. That looks like a decent spot, though, to spend the night. Unless a big thunderstorm comes over, well, then I probably wouldn't want to be in that tree. But let's carry on around, of course, to that second buffalo. It's going to take us a couple of minutes to get there. But we're not too far away, probably about 3 or 4 minutes. Don't time me, though, because it may take a little bit longer. You know what I'm like, I get distracted by all sorts of things. Rebecca says that the timer has started. No pressure there. Thanks, Rebecca. Actually, I may get there in time. Not too far away, but we've got to roam around on this road. Bye, vulture. Don't want to bother you. Please stay there. It makes me happy when I'm able to just slowly drive past something like a vulture that was perched in the tree. The last thing I want to do is to make them fly unnecessary, especially if it has found a spot to settle in for the evening. Oh, we've got some impala. Let's see if we can get a glimpse at the impala. Now, Heidi, you've asked me if we have any Leleshwa trees. Let's see if we can have a look at these impala. Now, I'm not 100% certain what a Leleshwa tree is. And this is always quite a difficult process, is because there are so many different types of common names for the various trees all over the world. In fact, it's a problem that we do have. So Heidi, Leleshwa, that common name doesn't ring a bell. Do you perhaps have a Latin name for me? That may help a little bit. Not that I know all the Latin names of all the trees, but I know a couple of them, and that might help. Or even if you could maybe have a look and see if there aren't any more common names, and if you can give me a few, and then we can perhaps try again and see. There are so many different tree species in this area. It could be possible that they are. And just a lovely kudu and some impala, though, having a snack before the sun disappears. Now, I saw quite a few of you were wondering, and this is from last night, though, where do all the animals go when you do have a thunderstorm or a hailstorm? Now, the thunder doesn't mind them too much. I think the elephants get a little bit nervous occasionally. And of course the lightning, because any of these animals can get struck by the lightning. But I think when you've got hail like what we had last night, that's when you're going to see animals moving out of the open and trying to seek as much shelter as they can. And it's the same thing when you have torrential rain. I'm not talking about a heavy rain or, you know, drizzle. The animals don't mind that too much. But when you've got that torrential downpour, when it hurts, when the drops hit you, well, then everybody goes into all the bushes. And I can imagine if I were a lion, or actually if I was anything, I'd probably go down into the drainage lines where you've got some steep walls, and, well, probably stand up against one of the bank walls and get some shelter from the wind. And of course, we know when there's wind, the hail will come in at an angle, and so will the rain, and then you should be able to avoid yourself from getting injured from those hailstones. And it'll be nice to keep out of the wind and not be so chilly. Now you can see the skies are still clear on the other side, just a few low forming clouds. It seems as though everything is coming in from the west this evening. You can see it building up, although I've parked now right next to the trees. But you can sort of see it coming in very slowly. There it is on the left. And it's getting there, slowly but surely. And that's typically what happens, is that these dark clouds sort of engross the entire sky. And then normally the wind picks up, and then we get the big development of the cumulonimbus clouds, all those wonderful things. But it seems as though Byron has gone back to the Nkuhumas.
I have indeed. We just wanted to come back to see if they had moved a little bit. This is the male and female that we saw earlier, and as you can see, he's still resting very peacefully. The rest of the pride seem to have just moved further into the drainage line, and we actually can't see them very well. So we can't get down there. It's very, very thick. You can see all those trees behind those lions. It's impossible to get a vehicle through there. But at least we've got this beautiful pair still out in the open. And I'm hoping, I'm going to sit with them for a while, because I'm hoping that with it cooling down, we might get some activity. Maybe they move around. I know there has been a pair, well, it's most likely this pair, that have been mating. So you never know. I'm going to sit and watch. But their bellies, I think, are so full from all the buffalo that they've been eating the last few days. I think that's why these lions aren't too phased about moving around too much. You never know. Maybe we're lucky and we get them calling later, just before you leave. Maybe. That would be wonderful. That would be first prize. See that big belly of that male breathing very heavily. Seems like I don't have a worry in the world, completely relaxed. A lot of birds, mainly starlings around us, giving their last calls for the evening, or for the day rather, before the evening. Going to get the spotlight out soon, and we are going to continue our search for chameleons. Maybe we start getting lucky in the next few days because of all the rain we've had. We've seen some of the other animals that are active because of the rainfall. You know, we spoke about them earlier, and other reptiles like the tortoises, leopard tortoise, and that speaks hinged back tortoise. So who knows, maybe we're lucky and we see a chameleon or two hanging on the branches, maybe some scorpions. That would be great. But as we move further into summer, I'm sure we're going to have a better chance of seeing those types of little animals, those little creatures. Is he moving? No. Breathing quite heavily. And one of the reasons, well, two reasons why they do that. One is because they're possibly quite hot, so the lions do pant. And also when they are very full, if their bellies are full, lions do tend to breathe very, very heavily. We're so fortunate to be able to get this close to them and spend time just sitting, appreciating these magnificent beasts. And again, they look so peaceful, so relaxed. And we saw yesterday morning how quickly they can turn from these relaxed animals to poised hunters, and incredible hunters at that. Yesterday, they, you know, we spoke about it, and a lot of you saw, they took down 2 or 3 buffalo. So they've been very successful the last while, and they've been around this area for quite some time. It's been great because I think these lions have had these young cubs, so they haven't wanted to move very far. But the other reason is they haven't had to, because there's food and because there's water around. So they are very, very happy. It's been great for us. 40 days of lions
every day. That's incredible. That really is amazing. 48 days, 48 days, yeah. So Melinda has asked an interesting question about the ticks, and we've seen some ticks on the lions. And Melinda says she's seen ticks on a lot of animals, including the lions. And where do the ticks live? How do they come across these ticks? And also, do the animals suffer from any tick-borne diseases, tick-carried diseases? So I don't think they suffer from anything that the ticks give them. I think the ticks mainly suck the blood and fall off eventually when they are full. I've not heard or read anywhere that animals suffer from a tick bite disease. And Melinda, they occur in the grass, and we pick them up too when we're walking and tracking animals. We often get ticks all over us. We've got to be very, very careful. We often have to check our legs and our pants for ticks. And I have had tick bite fever, which is similar to Lyme disease, which you get in the States, but it's not as bad. And I have had that before. Generally what happens is you get a very, very bad headache, a fever, and you're usually down for about a week of aching joints and very, very painful. And it doesn't necessarily cause death, but you would have to take medication for it, and it's not very pleasant. But I've never seen a lion or anything like that with tick bite fever. Look at this male rolling over. Head right back. I think you can hear the wind is picking up a little bit. I wonder if we're going to have another storm this evening. See some clouds building in the distance where we had that sunset earlier, but not quite as threatening as it was last night, but you never know. We're going to sit with these lions a little bit longer. I think while we do that, Taylor has found a dead buffalo, perhaps one of these that they fed on yesterday. Let's have a look.
Now, this is the buffalo that we saw a few mornings ago that had sustained a horn injury from, I presume, another male buffalo. Perhaps they were having a bit of a argument, and it ended unfortunate for this male, where he ended up bleeding out, which was quite terrible. Now, it's only since yesterday morning that we didn't come and check it. Well, we haven't checked him since, and he's bloated up, and of course the flies have laid their eggs, and the larvae has indeed hatched. Now, this is quite gross and gruesome, so if you are a little bit sensitive, you're welcome to turn away for a few minutes. But this morning we had a question asking about how important flies are, and we can clearly see, because nothing else has touched this buffalo carcass, it is just the maggots and the flies that are here, and they will eventually eat a lot of this buffalo, and then it will start to decompose, which is good. We even saw a few ticks that are still hanging around on the buffalo, which is quite surprising. I would have thought by now, there it is, look at that big tick. I wouldn't have thought that there would be much blood flowing in this buffalo after a few days. Look at it, it is so fat and so full that it can barely move. If you turn your volume up, you might actually even be able to hear the flies buzzing. Did you see that? The fly on the tick? That was funny. That would have been a very slow form of transport if that fly stayed on that tick. Now, it's a massive buffalo. There is so much food here. I can't believe that the vultures haven't seen it yet. I thought it was tucked under a tree a little bit more, but it seems to actually be out in the open quite a bit. And it'll be interesting to see tomorrow morning if the hyenas have come across the half-eaten carcass that we just saw, or if they are going to find this one and start devouring it. Now, I wouldn't want to be around when whoever decides to come and feast on this buffalo opens up the stomach. I can't imagine that that would be a very nice smell. It's bloated up quite a bit now, and I think if you severed it in the wrong place, it would pop like a balloon and it would be very, very smelly. You can see this is where the injury came from. It seemed to have been a horn to the scrotum, to those sensitive bits there, and unfortunately there are a lot of blood vessels there around that area, and this poor buffalo bull bled out. But this is the circle of life, of course, and it's an important one, and it's something that we all just have to understand, that this is indeed nature. You see, even the eyes are still intact. Look at the beautiful flies. And David, you're wondering, why do ticks need to drink so much blood? And it's purely just because of food, very much the same way that a lion's body is designed to sort of, when they gorge themselves, they blow up like a balloon. Well, the same thing happens with a tick, is that it feeds and feeds as much as it can, and its body stretches out to its absolute maximum. And it might not find another host for a few days, so it's going to have some sort of resources, fat reserves, I suppose, or blood reserves, in order for it to carry on living in case it doesn't find another host. You can imagine at this speed, it would be quite difficult for, and also of its size, for it to latch onto another host. So it is probably going to have to wait until it gets a bit smaller. There isn't any long blades of grass around at the moment, which we normally see the ticks sitting on, waiting for an unsuspecting victim to pass by through the long grass, and then it's quite easy for them to get caught on the coat of an animal and take it from there. But like I said, with there not being much grass around, it just makes it that much more difficult, for even the ticks are going to be struggling during this period, but not for long. 20 mils of rain, and we should have a good amount of grass in the next couple of days. But we're so sorry, buffalo, but you have sacrificed yourself to nature, and you're going to supply somebody else with a meal. Now, Valerie, just having a look at their face, Valerie wants to know, why are the animals' eyes always open when they die? They never seem to be closed. I think it's just in their last dying breaths, that's sort of something that they don't think to do, is close their eyes. It's the same thing, unfortunately, with people and anything really, is that it isn't a natural thing just to close your eyes. It's sort of an involuntary movement, I think, when you pass on. And I believe that back in many, many years ago, they actually used to put coins on people's eyes who had passed away out of respect, to try and keep the eyelids closed, because it's not uncommon that muscles will start to tense up in the rigor mortis period, and then of course causing muscle twitching, or in fact like this, something like this, the eyelids to actually open up again, which could be quite disturbing and quite distraught. But it's getting a little bit dark now. Brian and I are going to have to try and meander out of this thicket. And you can see that the ground has dried quite nicely. I was quite happy to come and off-road here. But let's leave this buffalo, rest in peace, and go and see how the Nkuhumas are doing.
This male's just lifted his head, and he's, and the flies seem to be bothering him. Here's the male with that very bad scar on the side of the face. You'll see it shortly. Look at that. Possibly, we're not exactly sure what happened there, if it was a fight with another male, or possibly a horn from all these buffalo that they've been hunting. You can see the scars on his face. I bet you this male has got many stories to tell. Oh, that doesn't look very nice at all, that wound. But I must admit, these big cats have an amazing ability to heal very, very quickly. And I've seen lions, I've seen leopards with serious, serious injuries where some of their legs have been cut open from stumps that they've run into while hunting, and bad, bad wounds that we thought, oh, it's impossible that this animal would live. And they heal, they come out of it. It's incredible. They tend to heal very, very quickly, as long as they can try and keep it clean. Occasionally, they'll clean each other's wounds, and that will help. So Nathaniel has asked, have I ever seen a buffalo attack or kill or injure a lion? And Nathaniel, I have. I've seen buffalo when lions have been hunting them, and the buffalo eventually decide that they had enough and they turn around and work together as a unit and chase the lions away. And I have seen lions get horned by buffalo. They weren't badly injured. They managed to get away. And I've seen them run up into a tree. We had about three or four lions in a tree with the buffalo underneath them. Very, very scared. So because the buffalo are so powerful, they're able to do that. And they can be very aggressive if they feel threatened, as we spoke about earlier. So, you know, I have seen it, Nathaniel. They're incredibly, incredibly powerful animals. And if they get pushed, they will turn and defend themselves. Just getting back, we had a question earlier from Jessica. Jessica asked, will lions feed every day? So no, Jessica, they won't necessarily feed every day. These lions have just been very fortunate that they have had food every day because of the buffalo around. Generally speaking, it all depends on the size of the prey that the lions actually hunt and kill. So what happens is, for example, if a lion or pride of lions hunt something like an impala, they'll finish that most likely within 20 to 30 minutes, depending on the size of the pride. They'll finish that very, very quickly. They'll then move on, and they'll probably have to hunt quite soon after that, maybe the same day, maybe the next day. Something as large as a buffalo, if a pride of lions feed on that, and that could be for a day or 2 days for a larger buffalo, then they'll probably go 2 or 3 days without having to eat again. But again, all these animals, and especially the lions, are very opportunistic. So if there is food around, they will try and hunt. So it doesn't matter if they're hungry or not. If the opportunity is there, they will still go and hunt. So thanks for that question, Jessica. But they definitely don't have to feed every day. At least the temperature has dropped a little bit. It's become much cooler, which is great. Because it is quite tough to sleep out in the bush when it's very, very hot. These lions don't seem to have a problem with it, though. They're resting very comfortably. But there is this cool breeze at the moment, so I think they're very, very happy. Sounds like a lot of the birds have gone quiet, not as many bird calls around at the moment. The odd one here or there in the distance, but much quieter than 10 minutes ago, 15 minutes ago. So Jay has asked us a question regarding injured or sick lions, and Jay would like to know, are these injured or sick lions a risk to tourists on safari? Well, Jay, the whole time when we're out on safari, we've got to be very careful. These are wild animals and they can be somewhat unpredictable. So we do have to be very careful and very respectful of the animals. When animals are injured, they tend to be a little bit more unpredictable, and the reason for that is because they're injured, they're possibly not getting as much food as they usually would, and then they're not feeling very good, very happy, very very active, because they're not able to hunt. So all of those feelings then cause them to feel more threatened because they are injured, so that could cause them to attack, or rather defend themselves, not necessarily attack, but defend themselves if we get too close when they are injured. Usually what we do, I mean, on the vehicles, generally we are safe, and it's because the animals do view the vehicles as something which passes by, and they have become somewhat habituated to the vehicles. They know there's no threat or danger from it, but we are still careful, and we are still very, very sensitive towards these animals. We don't want to get too close, we don't want to push them and cause them to react. But if we were walking, it's a different story. When you're on foot, you appear to be almost like a different predator towards these other animals. So they will then basically act in one of two ways. They will either run away from you and move away from the potential threat, or they will get a fright, and because they become startled, they'll probably try and defend themselves, and that would cause them to then potentially react aggressively and maybe attack you. If you track or are following an injured animal, the chances are of a situation like that happening are a lot higher. So you do have to be careful, but it's not to say they will attack people purely because they are injured. So I hope that kind of makes sense. So thanks very much for that question. I'm going to sit here for one or two more minutes. We're starting to lose light now, and let's get an update from Taylor quickly.
We are also searching for chameleons this evening. Well, we've been actually been searching for them for the last few weeks, but they haven't come out yet. But perhaps tonight is the night, and we'll finally be able to see those elusive chameleons. I really need to slow down now, of course. Oh, of course. Have a look at this bum. I'm going to go back here. I'm not going to put a light. I'm going to put my... Let's do this light. Let me see if I can angle it up. I'm going to go back, but you'll see why. There we go. You can actually see it. Look at this bum that we're looking at. No, it looks like it's probably a crested frank. No, maybe a Natal spurfowl. Yes, sorry. It looks like a Natal spurfowl. It's sitting, resting, and getting ready to sleep. Now, the reason why I think it's hysterical is because of the angle that this bird is sitting in. It's got its bum poking straight towards the air. It's almost inverted. It's very funny. And quite a surprise to come across. There you go. It looks like a Natal spurfowl. Are you having a sleep? Are you getting ready for bed? I think that that's going to be a very windy spot, and you're sitting on the edge of a branch. So I hope you're ready for a wild ride on the roller coaster tree this evening, Mr. Natal spurfowl. But good luck. We will carry on. We won't bother you too much more. Oh, that was very funny coming across something like that. And that's what it's all about, is that you just never know what you're going to come across around the next corner or in the next tree. Even though it wasn't a leopard, it was quite funny, and it definitely brought laughter to my day finding something like that. But we'll carry on searching for these chameleons. Now, they like to sit on the edge of the trees, so that's particularly where we're looking, and the branches that overhang on the road. But when we do get some more rain and the grass starts to grow a little bit taller than just a couple of centimeters, then we're going to actually start seeing lots of the little chameleons, the baby chameleons, down on the bits of grass. So that'll be another spot to look for them. Oh, but I've got a spider. Can you get that, Ryan, or do you need to change position? Look at this spider that we've got building its web. Hello, bark spider. Looks like a bark spider. Now, typically, bark spiders only make their webs at night. I'm just trying to follow it and look at it the same. Oh, you're going too quickly. And it's busy putting its web up, and then in the morning they take it away. It looks like it could actually be a female. She seems to be much larger. Very quickly working, you can see, taking a strand from her spinneret, and she's attaching it to the next one. Isn't this incredible how she's able to work so fast? Can you see her attaching the webs? Look at that, adding new trap lines. Look at this. And she's got an order. Sorry, I'm trying to stay on the spider, but it's quite difficult because she's quite small. Now, typically the female spiders are much larger than the males. And this is a good spot, angled on some trees. And I think with all the ant alates that are out at the moment, we're definitely going to see some action, little spider. You've got a good spot. You've got to work. Oh wow, not even bothered by us. You've got a long way to go. It seems as though she's probably just started. She's working her way from the outside towards the inside of the middle of the web. That is incredible, and she's not going to stop until she's finished. I would be exhausted by now. Off you go, keep going. Rebecca, you are very funny this afternoon. Rebecca says that it's like she is doing laps around quarantine, which is the big open area, and that's what all of us ladies have been doing lately, is running around and around in circles, very much like the spider is doing at the moment. Though I think the spider looks a little bit more graceful compared to the way we do things. What do you think, Rebecca? Struggling a little bit in the wind. You can see how it's picking up now. And it's incredible also how she's able to produce so much silk. Sorry, it's a little bit bright there. Let me try and shine the light a little bit off her. You can see how big the web is. Right, but we're going to leave the spider in peace to do her thing. But I hope you enjoyed the show this afternoon. It's been an absolute pleasure once again. And thank you for all the lovely chats. And I look forward to tomorrow's Sunrise Safari. So from myself, Brian, and in case you forgot who the thumb was today, Fiona, I know you were wondering. We're going to have a quick look at the thumb. There's the thumb, raincoat thumb. And we all wish you a good farewell. And we'll see you bright and early tomorrow morning.
Thank you very much, Taylor and Brian. It was a lovely afternoon. I'm glad Taylor got to show you that bark spider. One of my favorite little spiders. These lions, however, have not moved an inch. They're still very, very comfortable, very, very relaxed. I'm assuming they'll probably only get moving much later.
We'll see what they get up to during the evening. Possibly find them tomorrow morning. Maybe they've killed something else if they do decide to go hunting. And it's not like there's a shortage of food. There's a lot going on. But it's been a wonderful, wonderful day. A lot of activity. Lions, elephant, buffalo, and some interesting little things. We had some great birds this morning and this afternoon. So I hope you have all enjoyed it with us. So don't forget to join us tomorrow again for our sunrise drive. It'll be great to have all of you viewers with us. Thank you for all the questions. It's been great. I really hope you've enjoyed today with us. We look forward to seeing all of you tomorrow. Thank you to Zander on camera with me this afternoon. And thank you to the voices in my head, or rather the ladies in FC, Kirsten and Rebecca. People often laugh at me when I say the voices in my head. And don't forget, tomorrow morning again, we'll be live here at Juma. So thank you very much for all the questions and comments. We will see you all tomorrow morning. Have a great evening wherever you are around the world. Good night and goodbye, everyone. Thank you.